Welcome back to Le Mans on board with the number 73 Corvette in the GTE Pro class. This car driven now by Jordan Taylor, one of two sons of Wayne Taylor. Ricky, his brother, is also racing here. Ricky Taylor in the number 50 Labra competition Corvette. Jordan in one of the factory cars he shares with Antonio Garcia and Jan Magnussen. So in amongst the established hot shoes at Corvette. And this car is currently, let's see if we can work this out, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8th in the GTE Pro class. Teammate Oliver Gavin in the 74 is 7th in the GTE Pro class.
We said actually, Martin, that it's been odd this year. The Corvettes have not been as competitive as they very often are. They make just the same noises, but for some reason or other, they just don't seem to be quite au point.
Well, one of the things that they discovered after practice and qualifying is that they clearly did not know enough about the new compound Michelin tyre, which is being used for this year. Now, all the other teams had these tyres available for pre-Le Mans testing in the Spa 6 Hours. So all the European teams that raced in the World Endurance Championship came to the Spa 6 Hours. Michelin brought the new tyres that were going to be used at Le Mans. And Chevrolet discovered them in the test weekend, which was wet, and then in free practice and qualifying, which was partially wet, partially nasty, and frequently red flagged. So they found themselves struggling, despite the computer simulations they might have had tied in with the Michelin data, to actually correlate what they should have got and what they were getting, and then what that meant. And then to set up the car for a tyre which they'd never actually physically had on the car before. So they feel that they're 6 hours and a lot of development work behind their rivals in the GTE class. And that is the Jota car. Third in the LMP2 class, Lucas Lure has gone off on, I'm going to say, the exit of Indianapolis, the slow left, and has gone around the gravel and found terra firma and rejoins. And I'm hoping that is A-OK. That's not Indianapolis.
That's
then.
Coming down to Tetra Rouge.
Yeah, so that's the end of the S's.
He's got a problem, hasn't he, of some sort or other?
It looks to me that it's a little bit down on
it's
the...
It's limping.
Yeah. Has he got a puncture?
Lucas Lewis not in the habit of tubbing cars into the gravel.
I should say,
judging by the speed he's going.
His offside rear tyre.
No, it's front. I think it's front.
Well, we'll have a look.
Yeah. Down.
Look, have a look as he goes around to the right there.
Well,
something,
the
something
right
ain't
seems
what it used to be, is it?
Yeah. Oh, dear,
right.
I think he's got a bit of a left side deflation, hasn't he?
I think it's all too much for him. Well, in fact, all too much for all three of them, as far as I can recall.
Well, why not? I mean, and actually, somebody asked on Twitter earlier on, when do the mechanics change their shift? I beg your pardon? Oh, no. How very no. No, they arrive at 6 o'clock on race morning on Saturday, and they go home, if they're lucky, at 6 p.m. on Sunday. So it's a proper 36-hour race. And, of course, when that starts, you would have hoped that you didn't spend all of Friday rebuilding a car that was wrecked on Thursday, as quite a number of teams have. Quite a number of teams will have done an all-nighter Thursday, worked all Friday, or done work all Friday, pull an all-nighter Friday night in preparation for a 36-hour day on Saturday. So they snooze between pit stops, and they hope that when they wave the car away, it jolly well does not come back in two more laps.
Well, that's the way it used to be in Formula One now. I mean, you can't work too much overtime, you know, too much.
Well, Nev, Formula One, it may have escaped you, although their races do seem like they go on all day and all night. Don't go on all day and all night. There is no need to sleep in the middle of a Formula One race.
No.
And you're not allowed to pull an all-nighter.
That's what I'm saying.
They close the pits.
They do all this.
Indeed.
The other thing, of course, is that it's a very different ball game now to that which it was going back years ago.
What is football?
No, if you actually have a problem with the engine, you don't repair it, you change it.
Well,
you can't do that in Formula One now.
No, indeed. Or here, if you have
penalized.
A problem with the engine, you pack up and go home.
Yeah.
That's one of the few things you can't change. If you have a problem with the engine, you go home. And again, the drinks bottle and the screen wash bottle being changed.
So, still lapping in the 330s.
Car 3 straight on at Marshall's Post 61. That's the second chicane as we see the number 1 car leaving successfully
Jeanet in number three.
Yes. Chasing Alexander Wurz for third place. Mm. So the recovering delayed number three Audi. And I'm going to say Ollie Turvey. I don't mean that, do I?
No.
No, I don't. I mean, Ollie Jarvis, too many Ollies. See, one is enough, two, one too many. No disrespect to either, because they're both doing a good job. Ollie Jarvis doing a really good job in that number three car during the night and handing it over at dawn's first light to Marc Jeanet. Jeanet just going straight on, and that happens occasionally. You just, and again, entirely likely to have been in traffic, just finding the gap he was going for meandered into and having to straight line the chicane. That's why they have a runoff area, or the road, as it's normally called in the other 51 weeks of the year. Because as you sit here, passing the restaurant on your left, this is the Route Nationale. This is the road from Le Mans to Tours. And these bits here don't get used for 51 weeks. This bit here gets used all 52.
By lorries that cut grooves in it when it gets very hot.
Well, they do, and as in any road, in fact, on, you know, even on any motorway, yeah, the trucks are all of a certain axle width and obviously a fairly prodigious weight, and they compress the tarmac into fairly noticeable channels. So what happens when it rains? Of course, those fill up with water. Whoa! And that's another one off. And is that...
same place.
Not the same car.
No,
it's the KCMG car, fairly predictably, but yes, same place. Is it... slippery there? Is it drizzling there? Yes. Leaders in.
Yeah, number two car.
Just under 9 hours to go. There's still an enormous amount of running still to be done.
Change the bottles.
Drinks fine. I can't be bothered to find that. One of them is a drink and the other one isn't, and we know that, and they know that, and they know which is which, and we don't have to. But
they are... the drinks bottles are a special design, which is done by Progressive Motorsport of Banbury.
I know.
And
if I could be bothered to look back for the tweet, I could tell you that the blue one is one and the silver one is the other, but I can't.
So there.
In fact, we... talking to the doctor who puts all their drinks together, it's mainly sugar. So sugar and water, yeah, mainly. Not exclusively, I mean, it is much more sophisticated than that, but yeah, mainly sugar and water. So the Audi leads still, number two Audi, from the two Toyotas, second and third, a lap back. A lap behind them, the number three Audi, and then 7 and 10 laps back, the two Rebellion Lola coupes with their Toyota engines. And on the same lap as the 12 is the 21 car, the remaining car, or the Strakka car rather, and ahead of the remaining Audi, which is a further lap back from them. And in fact, the battle between Neil Yarny and Johnny Kane is under a minute for seventh place.
How times change now. I was thinking when you were talking about that, that in the days of Aston Martin and John Wire, the wives did the food.
Well, now the wives get to eat most of the food.
Yes. Exactly.
The wives are fed pasta and chicken and pasta.
Yeah.
GT Pro leader, still Richard Leitz's Porsche from the Aston Martins of currently Bruno Senna and Stefan Mucha. Porsche, Patrick Pilet in fourth. Giancarlo Fisichella and Tony Wielander in AF Corsa Ferraris, fifth and sixth. And in the AM-class, Raymond Narak's Porsche still out front. The Porsche's going on there. Head of the Ferraris of Darrell Young and Matt Griffin. So despite what his indicator light said on the side of his car as he left the pit lane, seems that Raymond Narak is still in front of Darrell Young and Matt Griffin, who are 55 seconds apart, but not on the same lap as the leader. And I will go to my little map.
Yeah.
And see if I can find out how far apart they were. They were about a chicane. Ah, well, Darrell O'Young is currently in the Porsche curves, and coming down to Arnage is the 76 car of Raymond Narak. And I can tell you that because it's a fact.
There's the Jota Sport car, finally made it back to the pits.
So they will fuel it first rather than paying attention to anything else, because, of course, when they paid attention to anything else, it will still need fuel. So fuel goes in first, then car goes into garage, little trolley dolly wheels, spin it round, and again, failing to knock over their own teammates, so it still can be done. And into the garage it goes. Why does it go into the garage? Because you're only ever allowed two people working on a car on the pit road. And the reason is to stop pit road becoming insanely crowded with people and legs and bodies sticking out into the pits. Into the pit road, rather.
Right, I'm going to say goodbye to you two gentlemen. I'm off for a cup of coffee, and I'm going to leave you with Martin and Neville and Liz Halliday.
I think, actually, I'm going to go as well and leave you with Liz Halliday, who is far better looking than any of us in here. We might leave Cole here, but perhaps we'll take him.
Oh, dear. The KCMG car, a DKR car, again finds the gravel trap. And again, it is Monsieur Brondelard who is testing everybody's patience. So we bid goodbye and say thank you very much indeed to our night shift graveyard crew, Neville Hay and Chris Parsons. We'll see them a little bit later. And as we take a quick commercial break, it is still the number two Audi that leads this race. Sprinkle of rain, never too far away. But at the moment, safety car free for almost the whole of the last hour as we continue our live coverage of Le Mans here on Eurosport. Welcome back to Le Mans, 24 hours of Le Mans 2013. Perm those to make a proper sentence. We are inside the final 9 hours. We've broken the back of this thing. Now we're on the home stretch. There's just about 9 hours. What's that? 5 Grand Prix still left to work our way through. And we have still nearly 50 cars of our original 56 starters still running. Good morning, everybody, wherever you're joining us at Oh Dark Hundred. 6 o'clock here in the Circuit de la Sarthe, 4 GMT. I have no idea what time of day it is wherever you are, but thank you for being with us. Martin Haven, Liz Halliday and Mark Cole. And so far, as dawn rises, we've spent the last hour or so without drizzle, without safety cars. And that might be something of a record as far as hours go in this year's Le Mans, because we've already had a record 8 safety cars and we've still got 9 hours to go. It could do anything, because Liz, the weather has not been anybody's friend really this weekend.
Well, no, and we got up in the morning to see that, yes, it's been raining again. Not that we've had a huge sleep, about 2 hours, Mark Cole and I have, but noticed it had been raining and we're thinking, oh gosh, what are we going to come back to? But I'm amazed there's not been any safety cars. I don't remember the last time through the middle of the night we haven't had any accidents or anything.
We just haven't had any in the last hour. That's all I'm saying.
Oh, I see. I thought you were saying there hadn't been any. I was going, wow, that's amazing.
A whole hour.
Oh, I see. Okay, that makes more sense.
Yeah. And we left you on 5 safety cars last night, Martin. Is to say 3 more during the night.
Another, I see. That makes more sense. I was very confused. I was thinking, wow,
Martin, I understand another punching exercise.
Yep. I'm afraid so. I have to say, actually, you know, we always say hats off to the marshals, all the officials and the corner workers, especially the unpaid marshals who come and volunteer for free just for the fun of being trackside at Le Mans. Scrunch that paper more noisily, Mark. But the guys that are repairing the barriers, boy, they're going to be exhausted, because they are cutting and hammering and heaving and banging and everything into position. They're going to be absolutely Christmas crackers. Michael Krum handing over to Jan Mardenborough, the 41 Greaves Motorsport Nissan. And they are, I can't see that screen. I'm going to have to swap my lovely movie picture screen for a page one of the timing screen. They are third still in the LMP2 class. Olivier Plaz, Morgan Nissan leading it. And Bertrand Baguette, Bertie Breadstick, has now taken over from Martin Plowman in the car that is in second place.
So give us a little review, Martin. Let's just remind people that are just waking up and me and Mark what's happened through the night, what the drama is.
That's a very fine idea. Well, the race started, of course, with Audi 1-2-3 Toyota's giving chase, and in the early mixed conditions, Toyota had a better suited tyre to the slippery conditions and drizzle at the start, closed on the Audis. And then as conditions dried out a little, Audi started to pace away and left Toyota trailing a little in their wake, in contact, but not necessarily in the hunt, because Toyota had not quite as much speed as the Audis, although they have a fuel advantage. A couple of problems for the number one Audi, a crankshaft sensor for the number three Audi, also dropping a couple of laps off the lead. Left the Toyotas first and second behind leader Loic Duval. At least he's now leading in the number two car. And that sole healthy Audi has stayed in front of the Toyotas, who have swapped positions with each other, but have not yet been able to get back onto the lead lap. In fact, we saw Loic Duval putting a lap on both of them during the night. From a 50-second advantage, he's now over a lap clear. So the Audi is stroking away in front. In all the other classes, actually, everything we thought we knew pretty much after qualifying has turned out not to be quite as true as we thought. For example, we were thinking in the GTE Pro class, we're going to have a battle between the fastest cars, the Aston Martins, and last year's winners, maybe the Ferraris. But no, it's the Porsches now that are first and fourth, with Aston Martin sandwiched between them. Porsche has just been relentlessly quick in the race in a way that it didn't seem to be in practice. In the LMP2 class, well, it was Perm any one of at least 10 cars for a potential winner, 15 for a potential podium finisher. It seems to be British-driven and crewed cars that are going very well. The Oak Racing Morgan number 24 car, which Alex Brundle's just handed over to pole sitter Olivier Plat, has the lead. Bertrand Baguette has taken over from Martin Plowman in his Morgan Nissan, that's in second place, and Jan Maardenborough, another British driver, has taken over a Greaves Motorsport British team Zytec, British chassis, in third place. And that has pushed John Martin in the Irish run Murphy's prototype down to fourth. And they're still too close to call in the LMP2 class. Positions have been changing with pit stops in that class, in GTE Pro. And in GTE Am, where again a Porsche has inveigled its way into the lead, and Raymond Narak in the IMSA Matmut car does not look very much inclined to give back the lap that he's won over the Ferrari battle for seconds. Darrell O'Young currently ahead of Matt Griffin by a growing margin. It's now out to a minute. It was around 40 seconds when they both pitted on the same lap last time round. Fourth in that class, Patrick Long in the 77 Dempsey Del Piero Porsche. The real loser in the AM class was the 88 Proton Porsche Paolo Roberti, that was tripped up by a very errant and mimsing Roman Brondola, who basically took him out of the race.
That was an amazing rundown. I was actually asking what happened over the night when we've been away. But all that, was awesome.
That was like nine hours.
No, I meant I know there's been some accidents. The safety car has been out of the mix. Yeah. And
rain,
a lot of people have been to bed.
Safety cars. Safety car just about to come in, started raining again. So they kept the safety car out so everybody could change onto wet weather tyres because it rained rather than just drizzled a little bit. And then safety car went in and then one more brief safety car appeared. Many yellow flags to allow cars to be dragged out gravel traps that didn't require a safety car, but yeah, it's
so who's it's been out who's had a bad time.
Shorter list is who hasn't,
right?
Yeah, okay. Loic Duval in the number two Audi. No, seriously, number three Audi's been off, one of the Toyotas has been off, half a dozen of the LMP2 cars have been off.
Tricky conditions, several
of the front rows. Yeah, I mean, it's you can see now from the overhead shot there is a light grey line. Oh, and here's the Jota car that was third in class. I was wondering where that had got to. That's been in the garage for several laps now. Lucas Lure brought it in after an off in the S and limped all the way round, and it looks as though it was not a driver-induced off either.
Yeah, that looks like perhaps there's been a suspension issue or something in there. That's what it looks like to me at the moment, but without being down there, it's very hard to say. But
interestingly, we left at midnight, and I left a list of who was out front, and it hasn't actually changed hugely. It's still the number two Audi, as you say, from the two Toyotas. That the only real change of note is in the GT Pro class. I understand the Bruno Senna car had to come in for some brake attention, Martin, and that's why it lost that lead to the Porsche. But otherwise, that's been rocking and rolling, hasn't it? The two Astons and the Porsche. Great to see Raymond.
Puncture for the 75 Porsche.
Great to see Raymond Narak up there, though. Of course, he won GT2 as it was in 2007. That was a famous victory. That car, which is from Rouen, has always been supported, hasn't it, by the by Porsche France and by the factories. They've always had a lot of assistance. And great to see Jean-Carl Vernet on board. He's a rookie. You can't believe it. He's the reigning. He was the reigning Porsche Cup champion in France last year, and he was a Peugeot test driver, but he has never, ever raced at Le Mans before. Astonishing.
Well, the number 75 car there is Emmanuel Collard behind the wheel. That is the car that took over the Garage 56, which was meant to be for improving technologies. It was meant to be the green GT car that was meant to come. That fell out at the last minute. Luckily, they got the slot, so hopefully they're going to get that car back out on the road very quickly.
P2 leader on pit road, Olivier Platt. One blue light on the side of the car means he is position one in the blue light class, which is for LMP2 cars, non-factory developed prototype cars, essentially customer cars rather than run by a factory like Toyota or Audi.
And car 42, that's Jan Mardenborough again in the Greaves Motorsport car, straight on at the second chicane.
Yep.
Jan's been having a baptism of fire here last night. He had a flying lesson, would have run credit to the airfield next door. He took off over the curbs, didn't he, Liz?
Yeah, fantastic filming of that, wasn't it? Wow. We looked at it and thought, are those all four wheels off the ground? Wow, it was quite high up in the air. But I think in this occasion, when I was just watching the filming of him coming down the S's, I was thinking, there's a dry line, but it definitely isn't dry just off the line.
Yeah.
And my guess would be that he's just put one tire off in the damp on you know, new slicks, and see you later.
And of course, when you're in a prototype, half the time what are you doing? Going offline to go around a GT car, and therein lie beasties, you're absolutely right.
And my guess would be he's probably just had to brake while passing another car, been on a bit of the damp, and has gone straight on. But hopefully there's been no foul. Oh my goodness, we have a big fire.
Yes, we do.
In pit lane.
Now, quite often these cars blow back through the exhaust unburnt fuel when they are started back up again. That looks a little bit more dramatic for level 5 motorsport. It's what it was. It's fuel coming back out of the exhaust, but it was just quite dramatic, yeah. Do you know what? The tyre fixer on it didn't want to hang around there too long just in case it all went woof again, did he?
Yeah.
Driver hanging on in there, though. Fairly dues. He's being a brave boy.
Oh, it's going again.
Well, that's probably because he's trying to fire it up. Marino Franchitti, trying to keep the engine running. Of course, you know, with all this drive-by-wire throttle and the engine ECU controlling everything, the driver may not have an awful lot to say about what's going on. Best just to floor in and get going.
Jesus.
And again, he does.
Oh my goodness, and it's not nice being in one of these cars when there's flames flying up behind your head. Really isn't a nice feeling.
Well, Marino Franchitti not short on bravery, hanging on in there. It, very easy, I would think, to bail out, but he thinks, no, I've got to get this thing off pit road and then it'll all be fine.
I'm quite sure that the team was probably telling him on the radio, trust us, Marino, it's going to be okay, just get it going, get it going.
Either that or running for cover.
Somewhere
between those two.
Between it, but it does appear to be all right now. We're up and running.
Well, again, it may well just have been churning on the starter that was throwing the fuel back because it wasn't catching. Of course, you know, with a turbocharged engine, the exhausts aren't exactly what you'd call cool.
No, definitely not. And Marino Franchitti, they enjoyed a fantastic Sebring 12 hours, a win for that team at that very, very difficult race. Many people say that doing the 12 hours of Sebring is like doing a 24-hour race, certainly for the car components and the drivers, because it is a real hammering there. So very
half
good
as long,
them.
But twice as hard. That's
exactly
what they like to say in Sebring.
The track's starting to come back to the races now, Liz. Patrick Pile has just done the 91 Porsche's fastest first sector. And he's on a flyer at the moment, so after the overnight rain, it's all starting to come back to them, isn't it?
Yeah, and spot the ones that are in GT cars. They'll be finding these conditions easier to be a little bit quicker in because they won't be doing quite as much passing. And there is that helmet we've been talking about. Fantastic. It really does look like goggles on there.
Really does, doesn't it?
Some of you have tweeted us the pictures earlier on in the race. Thank you, and I have retweeted those.
IndyCar driver Mike Conway going the whole hog with his helmet, the old-fashioned look for his first ever Le Mans.
And incidentally, I believe that helmet designer is the same who does Lewis Hamilton's helmet, I understand.
Okay, well,
so clearly he knows what he's doing.
Yeah, I have to say he clearly does.
Is that Lewis I can't drive any slower Hamilton? That one.
Yeah, it might be that one, yeah.
Incidentally, in that 33 level 5 motorsport car, it wasn't Marino Franchitti who was being patient, it was owner Scott Tucker who was sitting there desperately hoping he wasn't going to get fried. Did lose a couple of places, dropped behind Lucas Lure's car, and Natasha Gatchnang also got by. The 35 car still on pit road. This is currently in fourth place in its class. Oh, the leader up. Welcome back, Martin Haven, Liz Halliday and Mark Cole, covering Le Mans 24 hours for you as we get into the daylight hours. And we just saw Olivier Platt, the leader of the LMP2 class, make a pit stop. Bertrand Baggett in second place, making a pit stop as well, taking his car over. Mike Conway taking over the car that lies fifth in the LMP2 category as the sole remaining Lotus doesn't leave the pits at the moment. This is David Kreiheimer, and the car has now lost 5 places on track because it was in the middle of a tight bunch of LMP2 cars and is dropping fast, and it is on the trolley dolly wheels and going back into the garage. Car 40 being reported to the stewards for speeding in the pit lane. That's the Boussin-Gignon car. And that was, Rodin Younessi has taken it out, so it may have been him, or it may have been the driver who brought it in who was doing the speeding. I don't know if there was a driver change. We didn't see that stop long enough, I think, to tell.
A few of you have been tweeting in with some questions, and Paul Moore has asked, can you tell me who's the youngest winner of the 24 hours of Le Mans? Well, certainly, I think, correct me if I'm wrong, one of you two, but at least in the LMP2 class. I think it was my old co-driver, Clint Field, back a few years ago. I believe he won LMP2 at the age of 20. But I could be wrong, and there may be someone younger. I feel like maybe we've had someone younger. But Mark is feverishly looking through his book.
Outright winner, I'm not sure.
I thought maybe one of you would know. Outright winner, I don't know. No. But I think winning anything, I thought it was Clint Field.
Mark Patterson takes over from Karen Chandock in the Murphy's number 48 car. And where have they got to in class? 10th in LMP2. Have to count down because we just have a screen with everybody in order. And so you have to sort of count down the class because I'm not clever enough to subtract 19th from 9.
I don't think any of us are.
speaking
of the youngest winner, I think Mark Patterson is our oldest driver this year in this race, I think. Correct me if I'm wrong, but
I believe
he is.
That is correct.
And I hope that he's going to settle in and do a good job in these somewhat tricky conditions because, as we just said, the offline is not dry. And we saw in practice he managed 3 spins in 1 lap, which was very impressive. Especially that he didn't hit anything.
Well, we've now got to almost full daylight here at Le Mans without any early morning sun. The cloud have been so thick there's been no hint of the sun at all. It's 6:20. It's fairly bright and light outside. You don't need lights to see where you're going. And they're just on because they have to be on so that other people can see that you're coming. But as you can see from on board with our number one Audi, the visibility very good. It is properly daylight, but you don't have that glare into sleepy eyes through a grimy screen that, Liz, just is such hard work.
No, it really is. And I think a lot of, especially the open top drivers, will be very, very pleased that they've not had that blinding sunshine coming through. The other thing we get at Le Mans sometimes early in the morning is fog, which it doesn't look like they've had. You can get a thick fog over the Porsche curves, which I must say is very exciting as you come piling up. over into the first corner. We actually had Mike Sims asked, in fact, what is harder, driving at the dusk tonight, the night, or the night to dawn stage? Certainly in these conditions, this is much more favorable because we really didn't have either coming in tonight or coming into dawn. We didn't have that glare, which Martin was talking about. That's what certainly I've always found most challenging, and I'm sure most drivers do, because you can't choose a visor. You're basically stuck with going with the visor for the conditions you'll be going into. So, you know, you're sort of struggling to see. Coming into the Porsche curves is a big glare portion of the circuit when the sun's coming up. That's really difficult. But I think at this Le Mans, in a way, everyone will be happy that it's been cloudy in both of those sectors.
Yeah, that might be the only silver lining to the generally cloudy weather, mightn't it, that it hasn't got that low morning sun glare or low evening sun glare, because yeah, that is very distracting. The evening sun as well, particularly, always seems to me from the onboards down to where you'd least want to not quite know where you are, going into Indianapolis.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And then you're finding yourself having to do extra tape on a clear visor to try and stop the glare, because you obviously can't go into the dark with a shaded visor on.
Yeah.
Though I've known drivers that have mistakenly done that.
Yeah, you'd prefer not to, really.
But you're ready to come back to me on the youngest driver?
Yes, I am,
He's running in third place at the moment for Toyota. Alex Wurz, 22 years old, when he won for US Porsche in 1996.
And he went on to win again.
Overall.
On his first appearance.
Yep.
Yep, he should have quit then.
Yep, and just out of interest, the driver with the most Le Mans behind him this year is Christophe Bouchoux, 20 appearances.
Right. Wow.
And he also won on his first ever appearance, 1993, for Peugeot.
Wow, so he did.
That's pretty cool.
And hasn't won again since. Alex Wurz has, of course.
Yes, he has indeed.
Right. Wow.
There we are. We would have got it on the internet, but I'm afraid throughout most of this race, the internet's been down, so I've been scrabbling through books. Luckily, I had the right books with me, and
fantastic. Well done, Mark. That didn't take you long at all.
Well, we're looking there at the art car in the Oak Racing garage, and we're not the only ones looking at it. Men with laptops, men with things, men pointing.
Oh, come on, make it rhyme. Men with laptops, men with things.
It's poetry. Poetry doesn't have to rhyme. It has to get you to the heart.
It has to scan.
No, it doesn't have to scan. It has to get you by the heart.
Oh, yes.
This car has been almost nothing but trouble. It is currently lying 44th out of 49 cars that are running.
Well, they're changing steering wheel and some road signs while they're there.
Oh, dear.
Oh, here's one of the crowd's favourites. Aren't they wonderful? The SRT Vipers. Not Dodge Vipers, SRT Vipers, and they're very clear about that.
Kuno Vittma is the driver at the wheel of the car. Rookie, making his first appearance here, and a man I'm very glad to say is a proper height.
Doesn't that colour scheme work? It's great.
No, it is fantastic, and it's so nice to see them back here. SRT, of course, standing for Street Race and Technology, which I think I've gotten right.
Yeah, and, sounds right.
Brilliant to have them back here. It's been over 10 years since Viper has been back. Of course, they won here in 2000. One of their drivers, Tommy Kendall, has not been back to Le Mans since 2000. That year he was in a Porsche, but he said it feels like it's his first Le Mans again, because he's coming with a team that he's been racing with already, and it's been a great feeling for all of them.
Yeah.
A lot of camaraderie in that garage. They are all really proud to be here and really happy to have Viper back on a page here at Le Mans.
And this is the third generation of Vipers, interestingly enough, to race here. But what a great history here. And I'm just socket to Corvette. That's what the crowd want.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And I think it's been interesting, because asking them all what it's like, they've all said the car is really easy to drive. It's good in the wet. It feels fantastic. You know, all good things. I think it's just been a little bit too slow in places.
Now, those who have been watching since the darkness will recognise the car and the name. Roman Brondola off again,
this time
at Mulsanne Corner. He's the one that took Paolo Roberti out of the race. In fact, Paolo Roberti has been so delayed in the 88 Proton Engineering Porsche that they are only 18 laps ahead of Roman Brondola.
Should he not be getting some sort of warning from the organisers if he's been taking people out and firing it off every other lap?
He should be getting some sort of kicking from the organisers, which is probably why he's still in the car. The art car is going back together. No, the organisers have said they would investigate the incident between the 39 and the 88. Essentially, Brondola went off, meandered down in the dark, meandered down the S's, and as cars came up behind him, moved from one side of the road to the other.
Oh, that's always a great idea.
Cue Paolo Roberti running straight into the gap that no longer existed. He at that stage was fourth in the LMP in the GTE AM class, and the guy that was second, Daryl O'Young, having to throw his car across the grass at the left in the S's in a vain hope of missing everything, which in fact happened, and he came to a halt on the tarmac inches from going into the gravel trap at the bottom of the S's, and then spending three laps being dragged out of there because Paolo Roberti was closer to the crane, and so Daryl O'Young would again have dropped right out of contention. So yeah, Roman Brondola hasn't covered himself in glory so far. His time may be yet to come. I doubt it, though. Beautiful view down onto Mulsanne, heading off the old road onto the, say the old road, the current road, off the road onto the Porsche curves, this modern part of the race circuit that bypasses the old Maison Blanche corner and the old run straight down at high speed past the pit lane, which in up until the 1960s was just a set of stands beside the racetrack with no protection for the drivers or for the mechanics, and down into the Ford chicane, just past the building right on the very end there behind the big plasma screen, which is where our commentary booths are, and starting another lap of this fabulous circuit. And Martin Haven with Mark Cole and Liz Halliday here. Mark, always great to see this circuit from the air, because of course we're so close to it down at ground level that you don't really get an idea of the size of it unless you try and walk any great distance.
Yeah, and the other thing, it flows. Le Mans really, really flows. It's got these beautiful, fast, sweeping bends, and you get those all together and right. You've only really got one slow corner on the whole track, and that's down at Arnage, and that you have to treat with huge, huge respect. But as Liz will tell you as a racing driver, the most fearsome part of the circuit is what we've just seen, Liz, the Porsche curves.
Yeah, the Porsche curves is a place where you can very, very easily lose up to 5 seconds or gain it there without even blinking, really. It's just a matter of what traffic you meet, especially if you're an LMP car. It's a very high-speed portion of the circuit in one of those. You enter the corner with just a dab on the brakes and in fifth gear, flat through the next two lefts if you're in an LMP. And then it's the very treacherous right to left near the end. But as I've said, very narrow space, easy to lose some time. And here are some frantic people trying to get into this Porsche.
Our class leader. The other car came in and had work done on it, the 91 car. That dropped it a little bit back, but the 92 car's had very quick work on it. They did a bit of a brake change earlier on in the darkness hours, and it looks as though it's getting oil topped up. And again, this is a sort of 1980s Group C full service, 70 Corvette facing the wrong way again.
And this was the car that had that big accident before the race started. That was in practice, wasn't it, if I'm correct?
Yes,
morning warm-up.
Morning warm-up.
So, yeah, this car has had a tough trip, and I dare say their mechanics are already very tired after the work they've had to do this morning.
Been spending a degree of time facing in the wrong direction, and unless he can select reverse, he's going to knock the nose off the car again. 11th in class at the moment and outside the top 48, so he may be our last running car at the moment. I can't actually see him anywhere on page one or two of the timing screen, so I'm assuming he's on page three.
Andrew Scorgi has asked us on Twitter, has a driver ever been banned from competing mid Le Mans 24 before? Keep thinking this could happen to Romain Brandla today. Well, sadly, we do remember when Stuart Hall was excluded from the race when he was racing the Aston Martin LMP1 car for contact with, I believe it was the Greaves Radical at the time, if I recall. It was a really difficult situation because Stuart, of course, we know and love and is a very talented driver, one I've shared a car with myself, and we've shared the commentary box, and it was a difficult situation. And I think there was another one at one stage, but we'll go back to this number 32 car, which is looking like the front end is pretty punched into the wall and sitting in the gravel. He's asking them to push him back, which is going to be a big feat. Look at these two marshals are thinking, how are we going to push this thing back on our own?
Well, you know, I don't think there's a gravel trap that's had a quiet time of it. I think any marshal here at this race, when they go home, like most of the drivers, will know they've been in a race because it's been very, very busy. And yet again, can't say enough respect to the marshals for standing out there in filthy weathers with all sorts of cars throwing themselves at the scenery and rescuing them on a continual basis.
It's on the run down to Mulsanne, by the way. That car's gone in.
Oh, and he was just trying to leave enough room for the pro-class cars to go by him. I'm afraid left a little too much.
Maybe just a little too hot as well. Wow, that is that's Mulsanne Corner, that's Mulsanne Corner.
Okay.
Definitely.
Luckily, it's a soft wall there.
And I think he's just missed his braking point there.
Who's going very slowly? That's a very slow prototype in front, is it?
I don't know that it is. I don't think it is that slow.
Right, and as that was happening, we've got a change for GT Pro. Bruno Senna's gone through into the lead ahead of Leitz. They've both had pit stops now. Leitz is now on his outlap, but he has fallen behind Bruno Senna. So we're back to the situation that Liz and I left at midnight with Aston Martin leading Porsche, Porsche and Aston Martin. This one's just rocking and rolling.
Oh, what yes, a fight it is there in the Pro class. Fantastic. Leitz. It's a fight we sort of thought would happen, but I thought Ferrari was going to be up there. I really thought it was going to be
creeping up
and Porsche pushing.
They are creeping up. Giancarlo Fisichella is in fifth position in that class in the 51 Ferrari. This is Darrell O'Young, second in the GTE Pro class. Incidentally, our race leader, Loic Duval, on pit road for regular service. Raymond Narak, 55 seconds between Darrell O'Young and Matt Griffin, who we just saw. Griffin, I think, stopped on the same lap as Darrell last time round. Out goes the race leader.
And Matt Griffin, such a great driver and really enjoying this race. I can't remember how many appearances. I think he's only had one appearance here before and they didn't finish.
Yeah, it can't be many.
But such a good driver. I used to race in the same team as Matt 10 years ago, which is pretty scary to think of.
Spends a lot of time racing in British GT.
But he was a brilliant, really good driver and nice to see him here again doing so well.
Yeah, absolutely. And he will have been... he spent a lot of time racing with and against Alan Simonson, so he'll be really suffering as well. There's so many friends and former... Well, on-track rivals of Alan Simonson are here, as well as his family and his teammates.
Raymond Narak then on board the GTM leading car. Great performance again by Matt Mutt, IMSA Performance Porsche, and they really have got this car hooked up. Raymond's been racing for so many years, 46, but showing he can still run out front there, Liz, and this is just so, so good, isn't it? He's essentially a gentleman driver, but
very quick.
He is a Porsche dealer in Rouen, so that's why he's got so much factory backing.
Yeah, and he's gotten quicker every year, I think, and shown that the right package, really, in the AM class is to find yourself a quick amateur. Yeah. And there was a lot of chat saying the battle for the LMP2 and the AM class was going to be who was the amateur in the car, and was the amateur good enough to be up to scratch to keep pushing the time, and I think we're starting to see that in the amateur class.
Well, as with everything, it's the weakest link that makes the decisions, isn't it? And the strongest weak link, if you like, your strongest AM driver or your strongest slower driver in the car is what's going to keep your average speed up. And Raymond Narak, well, he's in with Jean-Carl Vernet, whose speed, although he's very new to Le Mans, is not really too much of a question. Christophe Bourret does seem to be holding his end up of the bargain, so we'll have to wait and see when Bourret gets back in whether that IMSA Matt Mutt Porsche remains in the lead of its class.
Interestingly, Narak is not just a Le Mans specialist, he's had huge success here, but also 2011 he was the LMS champion in GTM, and last year he was the ELMS champion. Of course, Lava Corvette just kept shooting themselves in the foot. They got disqualified from two races for being underweight or being too low, and then what was it? One race, their fire extinguisher was out of date and they were disqualified for the race on that. So Jacques Leconte had to get his team by the scruff of the neck and shake it. And okay, they did win Le Mans, but they lost everything else.
At that level of motorsport, I mean, if it was club racing, you'd go, all right then. But not at that level, not at international level.
Level of GTE performance is really starting to close up. 20 seconds now between Peter Dumbrecht pushing on hard in the Aston Martin Art car. He's in fourth place. Patrick Pilet in front of him, 20 seconds up the road. 3 seconds in front of Pilet last lap was Richard Leitz in second place, because, of course, that car is stuck in the garage, and that will change. Leitz will go from the lead to fourth as the two cars behind him cross the line. So that number 52 Porsche, 91 Porsche of Richard Leitz is back out on pit apron, and that's perhaps going to save them. There's a driver change there as well. Who has Richard handed over to? Not sure.
Patrick Pilet.
Yeah, and for the first time in the race, Martin, the Ferrari have made page one of our timing screens. That's in 24th place. Jimmy Bruni, he's just been in the pits for a service. He's back out on track now, having taken that car over from Giancarlo Fisichella.
Right, sorry, Richard Leitz is up into second place now. Patrick Pilet has taken over as Peter Dumbrecht goes up into third. The 91 car is on pit road. Patrick Pilet has taken it over. And he will go out in fourth place. The car came in from the lead. Still don't know quite what the drama was.
They were topping it up with oil, weren't they? So,
yes, pouring in a lot of oil.
Yeah.
And let's just remember the number 51 car. That's two of the drivers in Jimmy Bruni and Giancarlo Fisichella, who had that fairy tale win last year in the in their Ferrari in the Pro Class. After an enormous accident in practice and qualifying, they barely even got the car ready for the race, if I recall. It was really difficult. And you know, I think we were saying from the get-go, wouldn't it be wonderful if they could win Le Mans after that crash? And they went out and did it.
They did. It was the commentator's curse failed that year.
Now, in other news during the night, every time I mention somebody, within half a lap, they go off at the first chicane.
So it's your fault that people crash. So any of you out there that think it has to do with any of the rest of us, it's not. It's all Martin's fault.
In the same way you are the queen of red flags, I am the king of cursing people into going off at the first chicane. Although, now that it has got daylight, they appear to be able to spot where the chicane is slightly more easily.
And again, for the first time, we've got all four top pro runners. The first four are on the same lap, 208, with Bruni just one lap behind. That's going to change in a minute because the... Bruni is, in fact, he's just gone out. He's on his out lap. Timo Bernhard has taken over the fourth place Porsche from Richard Leitz.
Roel Goethe in the pit there, you saw there, in 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7th place in the AM class, in the GTs, in his Aston Martin. And it is his Aston Martin as well. It's going into his Golf liveried collection just as soon as they get it to the checkered flag.
Yeah, and
he will have created the car's own heritage, won't he?
Oh, yes, yes, in fact.
Which will be unique in his collection, I believe.
Wow. Just a few weeks ago, Roald actually bought the winning Golf Mirage that Derek Bell and Jackie Eakes drove in 1975.
Wow.
So that collection is getting better. He's got T-shirts with the cars on, which Stuart designed, and every year he's having to change the T-shirts because more and more cars are being added.
About
18 Golf liveried cars he owns at the moment.
It's pretty spectacular.
And Adrian Hamilton is one of the men, in fact, predominantly the man who has been putting him in touch with all the father of Archie Hamilton, whose car retired a little bit earlier on in the race, and, of course, the son of Duncan Hamilton, who was our winner 60 years ago with Tony Rolt.
Tell us about Archie's, then. That went out during the night, did it?
It did go out during the night, and if I had some of my wits about me, I could probably remember why, but I can't, I'm afraid. So might have to go and look for that on the sheet of abandons.
Couldn't be the Twitter orange fans if they remember, because we weren't here.
Couldn't be the orange rolled under the brake pedal.
Hoping not.
The thing was pretty petrified, so I don't think it would have had much give.
Service for Marc Genet.
Marc Genet currently lying in fourth place. This Audi creeping up towards the Toyotas. Now it's doing about the same lap times as Alexander Wurz in front. Sebastian Buemi jumped Wurz about a little over an hour ago and is still lapping 3 to 4 seconds a lap quicker than Alexander Wurz in his desperate chase of the lead Audi of Loic Duval. With 8 hours to go, this race is definitely not over for Toyota.
Welcome back to Eurosport live here at Le Mans. The time here is 6:45 Sunday morning. Spectators heading off for Mass. Well, some of them are heading off for Mass. And we've got a great race on our hands in GT Pro. We've got Bruno Senna from Richard Leitz, Peter Dumbreck, Timo Bernhard, and then only one lap behind them, Ferrari. Jimmy Bruni has finally hauled the AF Corsa Ferrari up onto the first page of our leaderboard, 24th overall. And Martin Haven, that battle's going to rock and roll. Surely all the way to 3 o'clock this afternoon.
Yeah, honestly, I can't see how you could even remotely think any one of the four classes is within 4 hours of being settled, never mind within 8 hours of being settled. This is just ridiculously tight in all the classes. Incidentally, just before we went on the break, we were talking about Archie Hamilton and his grandfather and the orange and all the other bits and bobs and Roel Goethe's collection assembled by Adrian Hamilton. And thanks to Adam Weller, reminding me that the number 30 car that Archie Hamilton shared with Tony Burgess went out when the transaxle separated from the rest of the car in a huge shunt at about 2 o'clock in the morning. Big shunt. I believe that Tony is A-OK, but the car definitely was very much split in half.
Well, we've got a problem for the leading Rebellion Lola. The rear engine cover is reported to be loose. Matthew Bechon bought that car
loose
at the moment.
A minute ago when we saw it go by.
But at least they've got a spare.
Yeah, and they're two laps ahead of sister car Neil Jani. So they've got the luxury of being able to make a pit stop and not lose position if they can secure that, Liz.
Yeah, Neil Jani lost that position. He had a bit of a long stop in the darkness again, sort of early hours of this morning, and dropped back behind his teammate, and that just hasn't been able to get on terms. Of course, two identical cars, fairly closely matched driver teams, as the number one Audi is finding very, very hard to make ground on similar cars driven in a similar manner.
Yeah, and just behind those two Rebellions is the 21 Stracker. Nick Leventis now on board the car, and Johnny Kane put it off again during the night, his second big off of Le Mans week. It's very uncharacteristic of Johnny, isn't it? But Nick Leventis, obviously the gentleman driver, he's that much slower than Benoit Trelier, who's coming in from behind, and Trelier almost 20 seconds a lap quicker. Yeah. And Nick surely is going to fall victim to him before long. Trelier in the number one car that was delayed with that, it was a crankshaft sensor, wasn't it, during the evening.
In fact, Johnny Kane looped it round at the Ford chicane, just backed it into the gravel. As we said earlier on, if you've got no nose, if you're going in, make sure you go in backwards. And at least he did that. No damage done. He was dragged out. It only took a couple of minutes, got dragged out, turned round and drove straight back into the pits for service. So no major dramas. But again, it was just an indication as conditions were going from night to light and from slippery and slimy to not quite so nasty, even the best get caught out.
Fastest man in LMP2 at the moment is Mike Conway, a blinding 3 minutes 40, which is by far the fastest time at the moment.
Wow.
Oh, 3:38, my goodness. And that's a lot quicker than anyone else in LMP2 at the moment. He's pushing really hard to gain themselves back up into a possible podium position at the moment and is hunting down Jan Martinborough, who just did a 3:43, which is still quite quick, but 5 seconds slower
than
what Mike Conway
is doing. And there he is on screen, Mike Conway.
Yeah.
Really flying.
Just
those of you that are just joining us, get a look at his helmet. It's been designed to look like an old-fashioned racer's helmet with the goggles up over the brow. And Mike Conway is first Le Mans. And like Martin Plowman, you know, done most of his single-seater racing career recently in the States. And both of them have put in singularly impressive performances here this weekend.
We're seeing some of the teams there wrapped up in blankets. It has been a fairly cold night.
I don't think those SR2 boys are expecting this sort of temperatures, because you don't get those in America except for Daytona in Florida.
Yeah, we just saw our GTE AM leader being serviced, Raymond Narak getting out of the car, and as Martin suggested, Christophe Bourret will probably climb on board that. Here's the number 8 Toyota, Liz. This is the lead Toyota. Sebastian Buemi stays on board. That's in second place. And it's 2 minutes 39 behind the lead Audi. So still on the lead lap. How good is that?
This is fantastic. I mean, we've come into the morning. It's daylight. We still have 3 Audis trucking around and 2 Toyotas. And 2 Toyotas are in the top 3. That's brilliant.
Are.
This is a much better fight than I think we actually even
expected.
First
thing we ever dared to hope for, yes. Listen, just getting back to Mike Conway while the time is on the screen, his last lap, his fastest of the race, 3 minutes 38.807. Fastest lap last year, 3:38.803. 4 thousandths off the LMP2 record, Mike Conway, on that last lap.
But Morgan are upping the ante just ahead of him as well. They've just put in, Bertrand Baguette's just put in the 35 car's fastest lap, and Olivier Pla is also on a flyer. He's just done his car's fastest second sector. He is the leader.
So first and second with fastest laps coming up. Jan Martinborough we're with, third in the LMP2 class, and that car's still really in contention. 3:42.2 to the 3:41.3 of Baguette in front, and the 3:43.9 of leader Olivier Pla, who's worlds more experienced than Martinborough at Le Mans, at prototype racing, and at everything else. So Martinborough right in the hunt there, and he and Lucas Ordonez and Mikael Krum could easily end up on the podium. Ordonez was on the podium his first ever race here at Le Mans in the LMP2 class, and Martinborough just could do exactly the same thing. And again, showing how that Nissan PlayStation GT Academy that Liz has been involved with has really come up with a great way of selecting these drivers. And somebody earlier on Twitter was saying, I really want to become a racing driver. At the moment, all I do is simulators. 2 years ago, all Jan Mardenborough did was play on his PlayStation. He entered a competition, the GT Academy, played on GT5, went to Silverstone, got selected, went through the tests, and here he is. He is racing at Le Mans instead of sitting on his couch watching it. If you want to be part of it, find out about GT Academy. Google is your friend. Other friends are available online. And, you know, you never know. You could be being grilled in Silverstone in the summer. And who knows? We might be sitting here talking about one of you sitting on your couch. And it's not just the UK. Wherever you are in the world, you may end up being part of the Nissan GT Academy
program. Your first step is buying Gran Turismo and get playing.
Yeah. Play Gran Turismo 5 until your eyes bleed and your and your thumbs are solid joints, because...
And then finish your homework.
Yeah.
But Jan has made a couple of rookie errors here at Le Mans, Liz, but that can be forgiven, can't he? He's only 21. It's only his second season of racing, as you say.
And his first LMP2 race. Yeah. And it's been a really tricky Le Mans, I will give him that. You know, you don't... It's your first Le Mans, you don't really want it to be mixed conditions, you know. I'm feeling a little bit smug now. I had a dry race in my first one. I'm thinking, thank goodness it wasn't this
one. Think of all the really good and really experienced drivers who have made lots of rookie errors as well.
Well, we just talked about Johnny Kane.
Yeah. Exactly. You know, putting a car off in a race like this and still keeping it going and still being in the hunt for the podium, that's not any disgrace. You know, when you finish this race, if you get to the checkered flag, boy, you're going to know you've been in a race, whatever car you're in.
Yeah, no, I think it's been, well, you're going to know you've been here all week and some of the trickiest conditions I can remember for them all. You know, I've spoken to a lot of people that have been here, been coming here many more years longer than me, that said they can't ever remember as many red flags in practice and qualifying.
Only one session. No session went through in practice and qualifying without a red flag. Only one actually finished with a checkered flag, and that had been red flagged in the middle as well. So, yes, it's been enormously difficult for teams and for drivers. And we've already had a record 8 safety cars. We've got 8 hours to go.
That's
over 4 Formula One Grand Prix. How many times do you get 4 Formula One Grand Prix in mixed weather without a safety car?
And I would love to sit here and say, well, now the sun's coming out. Yeah. It's going to be perfect for the rest of the race. But I don't know. I think we could still get some more showers or something odd.
But it could come. Honestly, if this week teaches us nothing, it could come at any minute, at any place on the track. So all these guys are getting as much shut-eye as they possibly can. You never know when they're going to need it. Stop and go penalty, incidentally, for car 40.
That's the Batsinghinian reconnaissance.
Well, that was handed a drive-through penalty for speeding before. And the weather forecast is for drizzle, 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 drizzle from pretty much midday on.
Quite situation normal then this year, isn't it?
Which will make for a very exciting finish to this race. I remember, what was 2007, my goodness, do you remember the torrential rain at the end of the race?
Wow.
At that stage, my car was out already. It had gone out at 9 o'clock in the morning with a gearbox failure. And I was sitting indoors, feeling a bit cheesed off that we hadn't finished, but thinking, gee, I'm glad I'm not driving in this right now.
Just occasionally, being out of the cockpit is not such a bad thing. 42 Nissan on pit road.
This is Jan Mardenborough.
It is indeed. BRDC Rising Stars driver.
And that's an early pit stop for him, has he not? I thought he only just went out recently.
Not sure, but
that seems a bit early.
There was
to me.
Nothing there other than fuel.
Maybe I'm just going crazy because I haven't had any sleep. But I'm sure he hadn't been in the car for very long at all.
Well, he comes out just ahead of Mike Conway, who's fourth.
How much in front of Mike Conway is
not
he?
Oh,
Olivier Platt on pit road as well. The leader in class is on pit road in LMP2.
He was due a
Patrick Dempsey getting into the number 77 car, I think.
Yes, he is.
They've had a very good race so far.
Have had a good race.
Yeah, he might be a star, but he has done all his share of the night driving.
Okay, yeah, no question. Yeah. I mean, he's not here to...
He's a good driver now, he is.
He's not here to flounce around and you know, just have fun. He is here to try and win this race. Has made mistakes, but then, you know, you show me a driver in the race that has not made mistakes, and I'll show you a very unusual individual.
I don't want to remind you of what you missed, Martin, but the caption just there, born in the USA, I thought, you know, just...
Yeah, well.
Oh, my.
That was a long time ago, that concert now, Martin. Did you get to Earth, Wind & Fire last night?
No, I didn't.
I was working the whole time, actually.
We had Earth, Wind & Rain last night.
Yeah, exactly.
And we had Greg Murphy, and he didn't want to go to Earth, Wind & Fire. We sent him the other direction to see the commitments.
Oh, right.
Now, if I'd known the commitments were actually here and that wasn't just a gag, I might have gone to see them. Andrew Strong, what a pair of lungs. Meanwhile, Aston Service, we'll get a quick break in ourselves.
You're here on Eurosport. We're just having a change in the cabin. Martin Haven, who's done a long, long shift on the long night's journey in today. Well done, Martin. Thank you very much. We'll see you later on. And Jeremy Shaw, hot off the pit lane, is just about to take over. And as Jeremy joins us, really, really exciting time, especially in the GT Pro category, where we have got a five-way battle developing between two Aston Martins, two Porsches, and a F Corsa Ferrari finally getting into the frame. It's taken them a long time. It's taken them some 16 hours to get to this position. But Jimmy Bruni now starting to attack Timo Bernhardt's factory Porsche. He's on the same lap. He's 2 minutes, 22 seconds behind. And ahead of him, Peter Dumbreck for Aston Martin. Ahead of him, Richard Leitz for Porsche. And then Bruno Senna, a rookie here at Le Mans, leading here after those 16 hours of racing. Jeremy, good morning. Good to have you back with us.
Always good to be here. Pleasure, honour, in fact.
So how's your night been?
I had about an hour or so sleep, so and a quick rustle up in the shower, sort of shower. So, no, feeling a little bit refreshed. It's great.
7 o'clock in the morning here, 6 o'clock in the UK, of course. So, that's where we are. And a strange Le Mans. We've had a record number of safety cars, 8 of them, I believe, now. 7 red flags in practice and qualifying, and it's been very, very bizarre, hasn't it?
Yeah, it certainly has, no question about that. Since not much has changed, it seems, since I left here about 3 o'clock in the morning, I think, and not much has changed since then. There's been a couple of shuffles down, it looks like, in the P2 class. Other than that, it's the situation as it was in P1 with the... Although the number 7 car has fallen a lap off, hasn't it, off the lead in there. There's the overall classification running down the order. You can see there the number 42 Zytek Nissan, Jan Mardenborough, doing a fantastic job there in third place in that class, behind only now the two Oak Racing machines of Bertrand Baguette driving the number 35 car and Olivier Pla in 24. And farther down the order, the best place of the GTE cars. There is a leader in GTE AM, car number 76. Raymond Narak has been doing a sterling job there, as indeed has Jean-Carl Vernet, who really has been a star in that car. It was a great stint.
Despite his history, his provenance, he's a rookie here at Le Mans.
Oh, well, he is, but he won last year's Porsche Carrera Cup Series in France. He's won the Indy Lights Championship in America before that. He's been finished second in the Macau Grand Prix. This guy's a superstar. Yep. He should be racing in a lot with no disrespect for GTE AM, he should be racing a series a lot higher category than that. Of course, he was a test driver for Peugeot before.
And he was ready to be given his break by Peugeot
absolutely.
At Sebring when they pulled the plug.
Exactly. He's a known quantity. The guy's quick.
Now, very, very interesting, Jeremy. Those top three cars in LMP2, you're just talking about the two Oak Morgans and the Zytek behind. All three have have Zytek engines, because those two more, but a lot of the field, all the Oreca Nissans are actually have their Nissan engines now prepared by Hugh Deschonac's Oreca team, but Morgan still had their engines prepared by Zytek, and it's a Zytek engine which is in third place in Mardenborough's car. So this, if the podium's going to be like that, it'd be a great, great day for John Manchester and all the guys from Zytek.
No question about it, and without wishing to take away anything from that, Mike Conway is his car, the Delta ADR car, that's using the Oreca Nissan engine. He just set fastest lap of the race in P2, so, you know, it just shows the equality of the competition, the the quality and the equality of the competition in P2, fabulous.
Yeah, we've got another Zytec a little further down, Simon Dolan, who's running seventh in P2, and right behind him, Scott Tucker with the HPD Honda. So it's not all Nissan. We've got Zytec and we've got Honda as well here running, so quite a good mixture.
Yeah, and the level 5 motorsports car number 33, it's what places it overall 17th, so it's a 9th place in the class. That's moved up in position since I left earlier on this morning, and that car's been fast, actually. They've had some problems. They had some, I think, engine management problems, effectively, all the way through the evening yesterday, which dropped them 7 or 8 laps, I think, or 4 or 5 laps at least, off the pace, ultimate pace in P2. But I think other than that, that car might have been right up in the front, because Ryan Briscoe, I think it was, did the first stint in that car and came from quite a long way down the grid right up into the top 3 or 4. So he was charging, and it was only a few delays that put him back in the pack.
We've got another change in GTE Pro, just going through the pit stop cycle. So Bruno Senna, who's just on his outlap, has dropped to third behind Porsche's Richard Leitz and his teammate Peter Dumbreck. And Liz has just arrived back with coffee and croissants. We are in France, of course.
Don't look after you guys.
Wow.
Right, so back on board with the number 8 Toyota. Just looking at this circuit, it's now looking dry. Even offline, it's quite dry, but you can start to see just some of the debris creeping into the circuit. We have been going for a long time now. And just a lovely helicopter shot here. Just gives you a great idea of the sort of lines these cars are taking and how vast the circuit is. It's over 8.5 miles long. A fantastic opportunity for anybody to come drive on one of the greatest circuits in the world. The longest straights of any circuit in Europe, I think possibly anywhere that sports car racing runs in.
Just about anything runs in anywhere, in actual fact. 3.5 miles, I think it is. I think is a funny story. When I first came to Le Mans, was not as a spectator at the race. I was just on my way down to the Monaco Grand Prix in the middle 70s, and I drove through as many sort of road race tracks as I could on my way down there. This was pre-auto routes, pre-payage anyhow, and I drove around Rouen, drove later on around Clermont-Ferrand, all the way down fantastic road circuits, and came into the town of Le Mans, found the Route Nationale down here, saw the Terre Rouge, those distinctive trees on the left-hand side of the track, so I knew exactly where I was there. But great, here we are, we're on the Mulsanne Strait, so we're driving on down the Mulsanne Strait. We can see the restaurant on the left, fabulous fun, wow, this is so cool. Driving along, that's sort of 55, 60 miles an hour probably, and driving along. And there's 4 of us in the car, in the Hotel Cortina, and we drive for 4 seasons like ever. Did anybody see Mulsanne Corner? No. Nobody saw it. Cracky, that's bizarre. How do we miss it? No idea. What do we want to do? Do we want to turn around and go back and find it and drive around the rest of the track? Because then you could drive around the whole track before the cut off some of the circuit. And we thought, oh dear, do we want to turn back and go back? We got an awful long way to go. Look, hey, we've seen Terre Rouge, we've seen the Mulsanne Corner, Mulsanne straightaway. Great. No, let's carry on. Okay, fine, great. So we had all this conversation and we're still driving. And what seemed like an hour later, wow, there's Mulsanne Corner. It can't possibly be that long, can it? And indeed, so that just shows. I mean, I've been around racing, several years, even at that stage, hadn't been here to see the race, but that just shows how long that racetrack
was. Have you seen the REM circuit?
Nothing like this.
Sitting on this, I mean, it really is a chance to have a rest, and it does, even at 200 miles an hour, it does go on for a long time, and it must sound funny to everyone at home, but it really is your chance to rest. You have a little, maybe just move your fingers on the wheel, have a little check of all your mirrors first, checking the gate, checking the telemetry, just making sure everything is where it should be. We heard the Audi drivers were saying they now get to scroll through the sort of a little screen on their wheel, and they can check the tire pressures of all 4 tires. I mean, telemetry has just come on so far, and it is fantastic. And quite often, what you're doing while you're just trucking along the straight is your team's maybe talking to you, saying switch to map 4, you can change everything. There's a lot going on other than just driving for all the drivers.
And that aspect of it is a little bit different now, because when I was first here, there were no chicanes down there. So
you had a minute or more of
twiddling your thumbs and more relaxation. Now, at that part of the track, it's actually a little bit more difficult because you have to concentrate on the chicanes coming up.
But at 1983, Derek Bell took me around in the Rothmans Porsche in the days when we gave Group C. Journalists were given media rides, and in that Rothmans Porsche, I had a crash helmet but no belt. I was jammed into the passenger seat, and Derek took me down the chute, and he took the hands off the wheel. He said, you know, we got tram lines from the truck, so take hands off the wheel. Anyway, we got back in after an amazing lap. And I said, what were we doing? He said, about 220.
Yeah. I wouldn't take my hands off the wheel. I'm all signed up there.
I was lucky enough to get a ride around here. It was in a C2 car, the Ecos car in 85. And boy, that was an experience. So we weren't doing 220, but we were doing just about 200. And that was running in a brand new transmission too. Incredible.
Lights flashing as this LMP2 car comes around, a couple GTs. As we talked about it before, these cars do have to run with lights on in the day and the night. It is a normal rule here at Le Mans, also in the American Le Mans series, ELMS and WEC. And actually, I think that's a good thing. It just keeps you clear as to which car is coming up behind. You've probably noticed that the GT cars have yellow lights and all of the LMP cars have white lights, and you can just get a good view there of how different the Audi lights are. It's a different shape, really, really bright LED lights. You can see the sort of the clusters coming down the front there.
And this car holding an unenviable record this year, the most stops. That's the 24th stop that the number one car has made. Of course, they're in the garage for a long time, having the crankshaft sensor changed.
I wonder if that'll beat our record. I think Intersport might hold the record of the most stops ever.
We've still got almost 8 hours to go. Oh, yeah, that was a year and a half, wasn't it, for you, Liz?
I think we had 48 stops or something like that.
Jan Mardenper has just done his car's fastest middle sector, and that's impressive. Here's a nice replay of the of Jean-Carl Vernet, in fact, and just looking at some of the other opposition, there is the 125 years of Dunlop car, and there, door flying open.
Oh, goodness, that's really open, isn't it?
And that was last night, and we've had reports again about 10 minutes ago that door is flapping open again.
Get the gaffer tape out. That's another job for gaffer.
I think when they had the court case last week, they took the door handles as well, didn't they? But the court closure now, and that's all behind us. So, ooh, messy.
There's another gaffer taped up car. I think we were all joking earlier, saying you could near enough build a race car in gaffer tape, but you certainly can hold most of it together.
And this is the other Matt Mook car. They've got two running, of course. This is the 67 car and the 76 car. They swap them around. Well, Liz, long way to go yet. As we said, almost 8 hours. And this GT Pro is just absolutely amazing at the moment, isn't it? It's two laps covering the whole field as they're going through the pit stop cycle. But up front, it's still Audi. Loic Duval from Toyota and Toyota. And who would have forecast that?
No, this is
3 o'clock yesterday
we're
afternoon.
We're seeing a really fantastic race here. We're quite a few hours in. However, everyone starts to think you hit the morning, you hit daylight on the Sunday. It feels like we've got through the night. We're getting there. And then you realize how many hours are still left to go in this race. And it's a long way.
Five Grand Prix
exactly.
Still to go. Yeah.
It's a very long way to go still.
And Mike Gascoigne made that point last night.
Did he?
It's really tough getting used to this. You know, I thought after an hour and a half we could all pack up and go home, and then someone said, no, you've got another 22 and a half hours to go.
No, it is difficult, and I'm glad that we've still got a fight going in every class. That's fantastic. By this time last year, the Toyotas were gone. We were just watching Audi doing what Audi does best, which is hammer along at the front. But this year, we've still got a race in all four classes going on, and it's a hot race as well.
Tom Christensen gets in the number two car. We're not going to give it the commentator's curse, but if he won today, 9 victories.
My goodness,
if he won
that's
today.
Quite amazing. And it would be his 12th podium. Do I have that right?
Yep.
Wow.
And Nishi would have 3 wins. So
fantastic.
Let's
that would
cheer
be great
on.
For them. It really would.
We are British Eurosport. Let's cheer Nishi on, shall we? Yes.
Absolutely. I'd love to see them on the podium again.
So, Buemi second, Alexander in third. And just to remind you, Alexander Wurz, the youngest ever winner of Le Mans at 22 years old in 1990.
Welcome back to Eurosport. We have a slow car here going along. I think he's just come out of the pits. This is the Caterham LMP2 car, number 41. Tom Kimber-Smith at the wheel. I'm not entirely sure what's wrong with his car, but it did definitely look like it was creeping down the Mulsanne straight, Jeremy.
Sparks coming off the front of it looked like potentially some sort of a puncture, perhaps. And you're right, it came out of the pits just a lap or so ago with Tom Kippersmith relieving Eric Lux at the wheel of that car. Here you can see now crawling down the Mulsanne straight. That's going to be a scary feeling too, hasn't it?
Oh, it's horrible. It really is horrible, because all the times you feel like those cars are passing you fast anyway in the LMP1 class, you have no idea until you're creeping along at the speed of a Fiat 500 would be in traffic. You know, it's absolutely horrific. And he's got a long way to go. This is when you really know how long the Le Mans circuit is when you have a problem early on. You're out there for just, it feels like hours. It really does.
Yeah, with cars flying past you, and it's not very wide.
It really isn't. And trying to stay offline is really difficult when you have a problem, because you can't move out of the way quickly. You're trying your best to continuously move off the main racing line, but in order to do that, you've got to take a risk of moving across the track slowly. There will be marshals flailing a white flag to show that there is a slow moving car that you're approaching. But even so, I mean, we've talked about these incredible speeds that the front runners are doing, and so service, no matter what's out there, it's going to be difficult.
Service for the 47 Morgan Nissan. This is the Chinese car, the KTMG car. Matt Howson getting out of the car, and was that Mark Alexander Imperatore getting into it?
I think it might have been. It's hard to tell, really.
We'll see as soon as he comes back on track. Yeah, here is Peter Dumbreck, the Flying Scotsman, literally in 1999 with Mercedes, but coming back and having a great race here, lying in second at the moment, but that is changing every lap between him, Senna, and Richard Leitz, and Aston Martin having such a strong run in this class. And of course, David Rich is telling us last night they want the win for Alan Simonsen.
And I have to say, I would love to see that today. I think that would be really great. I'm a big fan of the others that are running at the front, but it would be fitting today for that to happen, I think.
So Tom Kimber-Smith still limping around, and of course Tom's hopes of continuing his winning streak of three wins at Le Mans in just four appearances. I mean, that's as pro rata as good as Tom Christensen's ever done.
But, lucky bugger.
not today, sadly.
Go ahead.
He's limping around, and the car had already fallen some way down the order, hadn't it?
I was going to say, I think most people would be thrilled with three finishes at Le Mans out of four starts, let alone three wins.
Yeah, I have to say, 2 years ago, I was on the panel, the Guild of Motoring Writers, which is the motoring journalist organisation, and we voted him driver of the year, and that was over Lewis Hamilton. So it just showed how much respect his peers, his motoring journalist peers, have for him.
My goodness.
So Tom's still limping around. He's only got to post 63 at the moment, which is just coming down to Mulsanne corner. That's how long it takes to get round this lap when you know you've got a problem with the car and you need to get it back in one piece.
I think it'll take him on a puncture. Could take him up to 9 minutes, 10 minutes even. I mean, it's going to be a long slog. And the worse that the puncture, or the worse that the tyre gets, the slower he'll need to go to not risk tearing off bits of bodywork and shredding up the radiators and everything. So he's going to have to be really taking it cautiously and trying to not get run over at the same time.
So that's a huge problem if you have a puncture on the last lap, because you have to complete your final lap in 6 minutes. And if you've got bits coming off the car.
the only thing on the last lap, you don't have to worry about just sort of bringing it back slowly. Yeah. You can bring it doesn't matter how many wheels are on the car, as long as you get it to the finish line.
Definitely,
at the end of the race. But you're right, absolutely right, Liz, because the average speed of a front-running lap in LMP2, even, not LMP1, is almost 140 miles an hour. It's 137 or 8 miles an hour. That's an average speed for the whole lap. Well, if you try to do those sort of speeds with a tyre flailing around, you're going to do an awful lot of damage. So, 9, 10 minutes is quite conceivable. You've got to limp around the whole way, which is what he had to do. Also, what Oliver Jarvis had to do last night in the number 3 Audi R18 e-tron Quattro, because he got a puncture going into the Dunlop curve, so I had to do the lap all the way around.
And they usually say about 30 mile an hour maximum on a puncture. It's sort of a general rule, but a lot of it will be down to what the team's telling you. They'll be watching on the TV when they show the car. Earlier on, we saw a Ferrari that had a puncture, and in my opinion, he probably went a little bit too fast in, and it torn a bunch of the bodywork off the back of the car. And ultimately, you're not saving yourself any time, because whatever whatever small few minutes you've gained by coming back that little bit faster are spent putting an entire new bodywork package on the car. So really it's down to just patience and telling yourself that this is just where you are and you've got to just hold it together and bring it in the best speed that's possible for the car.
Just going for Indianapolis as we talk. In comes then for service. This is the number three Audi. Marc Genet brings it in. Driver change. So it's going to be full service for this car, Liz?
Yeah, it looks to be that way, going as quickly as they can. We can just see how fast and dialed in the driver changes are. All these teams will have practiced and practiced the driver change and the tyre change and the whole pit stop procedure because they know more than anybody that a race can be won or lost in the pits. Most of these drivers will have the change down to under 30 seconds. They should definitely have it down to that, and that includes everything. Driver in, out, seat insert in, water plugged in, radio plugged in, belts done, finger on the button, ready to start. And that's pretty impressive if you think about it.
Yeah, it certainly is. The number three car with its problems overnight has got within about 40 seconds of the third place Toyota, number seven car, before this pit stop. Another good stop there, I think, though, by...
That was a tidy stop. Yeah, that was good.
Yeah, the driver change, as he said, there is... Stefan Sarrazin waiting for this car, Sebastian Buemi. And Sebastian Buemi went there to wave to his cousin, Natasha Gashnan, because she's just gone back out after a pit stop in the Morand Racing Morgan Judd. So
was that a long stop for her?
It was.
I feel like they've been in there for a while.
It was quite long, yeah.
Yeah.
So Buemi then on his in-lap, just coming through Indianapolis, that lovely little bank corner. Can you really feel the banking on that?
You can, yeah. Yeah, I mean, obviously, it's not like a huge bank corner, but you can feel every ups and downs of this circuit, and there's much more than you can even see on TV, even just the little humps in the road just there. They're going over one. You just see the car humping. You feel everything in these race cars, and it's anytime there's any bit of camber on the road, it can either help to hold you in or push you away, so you've got to be really conscious of that all the time.
So photo opportunity for Toyota. They're running together at the moment, second and third cars. They are one lap apart.
That is.
Yeah, absolutely right. And but incidentally, that car number 41, Tom Kimbersmith, did make it back to the pit lane, and his sector time through sector three here, 240 seconds. It's a long way back. A regular sector time for a P2 car through there is about a bit over 100 seconds, so cost him a couple of minutes just in that final sector. But he did get it back, and hopefully they can get that car back into the fray without too much damage to that corner.
We expected Buemi to come into the pits. He didn't. He stayed out, and in fact, Wirtz just trying to pass him as they go up into the Dunlop curves. Wirtz trying to claw back that one lap they lost earlier on.
And I suspect perhaps Wirtz has got fresher tyres than Buemi. If he's due to come in, that might be partly why he's a little bit quicker, but I'm not 100% sure. But looking at their lap times, Sebastian Buemi was quicker on the last lap than Alexander Wirtz was, but that might not be the case this time around, although his sector times look faster. So we'll wait and see.
Blocked by the Aston there. Buemi just couldn't quite make the pass that Wirtz has. Wirtz has gone ahead of him then.
Looking at some who's doing fast lap times right now, Nick Manassian is behind the wheel of the number 49 car, the Orica. That's the PCOM car, clawing its way back up through the P2 order. He's just done a 3:41.8 quickest time for that car. Also, we've seen Mark Goossens behind the wheel of the 53 Viper. Recently did its quickest time. He did a 3:59.0, which is a very quick time for that Viper. One of the fastest, I think, the quickest time is probably done all weekend. Back on board of the number eight Toyota here. Heading down the Mulsanne straight gives you a really good view of how fast this is in these cars. You can just see everything flying by into the second chicane. Can hear the gears changing very, very fast. They'll now head on down to that run into Mulsanne corner.
Oh, Parc Fermé.
But what's amazing is how few cars are in Parc Fermé. I mean, goodness me, here we are, 17 hours or whatever it is into the race now. And generally, by this time of the morning, there's a lot more cars in there than that. Don't you agree, Mark Cole?
Yeah. Have they brought back the 31 Lotus? I don't know if that was there. I think that went behind the barriers. That's probably still going to be there. So
I think there are a couple cars out of the circuit.
Probably no more
but still not many. You're right,
five or six, Jeremy.
Yeah.
5 or 6 out of 56 starters.
Especially with the weather we've had.
Yeah.
I mean, if we were a bone dry, hot race, then you go, all right, maybe. But, you know, we've had such mixed conditions, especially in the night, have rain in the night. It's pretty good. Pretty good, I think.
Yeah. What time was that rain shower? Do you know, because it was after 3 o'clock, because it hadn't happened by 3 o'clock.
So it must have been around four or so, okay. Because we got up at, we were up at, 4:30-ish, and then,
It already
so
happened
it must
by
have
then,
happened,
it?
Yeah.
So again, the Toyota's coming across Aston Martin's, it seems, that almost every other corner, but running together, and as we said, Wurz has just hasn't quite unlapped himself. He's still being shown as one lap behind Buemi, but he is ahead of him now. But of course, that's not on the lead lap. So into Porsche curves again. So fast through here, Liz.
Oh, just unbelievably fast. Fastest collection of curves in the whole circuit. Fifth gear through most of that. Quite often fourth or fifth through this last piece. Usually it's fourth through the right-hander we saw before the left, but so fast. And not very wide either. It's quite narrow. It's very difficult if you meet a car in the middle, because you can come around the left-hand extremely fast in an LMP car and have no idea what's in front of you until you've arrived upon it. So it's very difficult.
Imagine Silverstone's Beckett's complex, but with walls on both sides.
Yeah, and faster.
And longer.
Faster and longer. Yeah, it's pretty wild. A lot of fun if you get it right, though. Fantastic.
Of course, British Grand Prix next weekend. There's Lena Gade, winning race director, car director for the number one car. Not this year, sadly. That broken crankshaft sensor that I suppose any other team would have just packed up and gone home at that, but not Audi. Nope. They've got a lot of guests here, and they want all three cars to finish.
Well, I think any team at Le Mans would have tried their absolute hardest to fix it. However, I don't know if the other teams would have had the resources and the ability to fix the car quite as quickly as they did at Audi. It certainly would have taken a bit longer, but, you know, I think most teams would do absolutely everything possible to finish the race, you know, if they could.
Got a moment here. This is such a tight, close brush with one of the Intermat Porsches, and just comparing the two cars. Bit of porpoising there from the Audi.
Yeah, a little bit. And I think the drivers don't really seem to notice that very much. I think it's less than we think from in there. But certainly a porpoising car is a little bit weird to deal with. It sort of messes up your vision, but I question if it's not really as bad as it looks to us, but it's hard to know without speaking to them.
I remember a couple of years ago asking about it, and they said, what porpoising? We didn't notice anything. So here we are, those two Toyotas still running together, and this is just a replay of what? Is this Buemi going back ahead of Wurz?
Yeah, I think that looks to be the case, yes.
Stefan Sarrazin then waiting to get in. And well, we're going for a break again, and we'll be back. It's now almost 7:30 in the morning here in France. Get a coffee, join us in a moment.
Welcome back to Eurosport's coverage of the 81st Vingt-Quatre Heures du Mans, the 24 Hours of Le Mans. Pit stops here for the number... the second place car of Sebastian Buemi brings his Toyota TS030 hybrid into the pit lane for, we believe, scheduled service. We were talking a few minutes ago about the number of retirements. There have been 7 retirements from the race so far with, 7.5 hours to go. It was minus 24, so 16.5 hours in the books. We've lost the 95 car, the 31, the 28, the 25, the 57, the 54, and the 30. Still 7.5 hours to go, but the fewest retirements ever in this race, as pointed out just to me a few minutes ago by Martin Haven, was 16.
Right.
That's the fewest number of retirements. Last year, there were 23 retirements in a race. There were actually only 3 retirements in 1923, but there weren't nearly so many. They weren't running nearly so hard either back then. We are on a pretty good pace here to get a lot of cars to the finish line, which really would be very, very impressive.
Only 7 is really not much at all at this stage.
No, that's
when we've made
point.
It through the night with only 7 is
absolutely
amazing, isn't it?
Yeah.
It is quite incredible.
Come on, this commentator's curse will kick in if you go on like this.
Oh, no, I better start. Yeah.
Don't do this.
Oh, no.
So if you're just joining us here, 7.5 hours still to go at Le Mans. Tom Christensen leads for Audi in P1. Olivier Pla leads for the Oak Morgan team in P2, ninth overall. Bruno Senna back out in front for Aston Martin in Pro GT in 20th place overall. And it's Jean-Carl Vanney in the IMSA Matmut Porsche leading GTM 32nd place overall. And as Jeremy just said, 7 retirements. So that means that we have at the moment 49 cars still running because we started 56. And
how's the wall chart coming along, Mark?
Yeah, well, we've got to start marking that up soon.
So. Oh, the marker of doom.
Yeah. Oh, man, look at that. That was a scary moment there, particularly for whoever was aboard the Murphy prototype, kind of a 48. He nearly got barged off the track and into the barriers there at the exit of Terre Rouge.
I think that's Mark Patterson, isn't it?
It is.
Who is this year's oldest driver at Le Mans.
Second oldest driver.
I think he's the oldest this year.
Here we go. Here it is again.
Blank 64. Boy, that was close.
And I didn't know that the oldest driver ever at Le Mans was Felbermayr Sr. In 2011, or was it last year? 2011,
ago,
I think.
And again, here we are.
Benoit. At 66 years old.
Benoit Trullier.
Oh, my goodness. Yeah,
through.
There it is. Wow, that really was close.
This is Benoit's local circuit, of course. He lives just up the road at Alençon. He knows it so well.
Maybe a little bit ambitious, though, that he literally just actually brushed him, I think. It was really.
I think Daniel Prostino would have been watching that, but he's a French driver, so.
Got away with it, just.
Yeah, and heads up driving there by Mark Patterson. I mean, he couldn't have got any farther across the left-hand side of the road.
No, he'd done everything he could. He definitely wasn't in the way. There just wasn't quite enough room for the whole Toyota there, just barely.
P2, Jan Mardenborough in the Zytek has just done another fastest sector too, so he is still flying the young Welshman, having such a good race.
And he's been super consistent too. He's been turning 3 minutes, 41s, 42s, 43s. That is very impressive in a P2 car around here, particularly given the fact that it's his first time here. I mean, it's very easy to lose 3 or 4 seconds, particularly coming through the Porsche curves. You get stuck behind a Porsche or something like that. And I every time I look at the scoring, it's around about the same sort of mark. I'd say Mardenborough has been unbelievably consistent in actual fact in terms of his lap time. Very, very impressive.
Well, yeah, very tidy, and I think the circuit is very fast at the moment. We're seeing quite a few fast sector times. This is usually when it's dry and a bit cooler in the morning is usually when we see some of the car's best times, actually.
No question, and we've seen it already. We saw Mike Conway set the fastest lap in P2 about 45 minutes ago, and fast is one speed, though, but it's one thing, consistency is another. And you consider the fact that 2 years ago, Jan Mardenborough had never sat in a racing car at all. All he was doing was gaming on that the PlayStation systems at home on the couch, basically. But to see the progress he has made, a new fastest lap for him, though, 3 minutes 40.7. It's remarkable what he's been able to achieve, and I know Darren Cox from Nissan, who's been involved in that program, set up that program as bringing on these young drivers, giving them the opportunity to drive proper racing cars. He's only going to put them into this sort of a car, this sort of an event, if they can. He knows they can handle themselves. And Jan, he's been busy. Last year he drove in the GT3 Championship in the UK, did the British GT Championship, did a super job there. Over the winter, he was racing in New Zealand in the Toyota Racing Series, and then this year he's racing in Formula 3 and getting a lot of mileage, and that's what this sport is all about, mileage and experience.
Yeah, and next weekend goes to the Nürburgring in the Formula 3, and we were talking about that with him, and what a difference from Le Mans to Nürburgring weekends apart. And if he goes there as a podium finisher at Le Mans, he's going to be a real hero there.
Well, he will be, and he's a very lucky boy, actually, because there's a lot of racing drivers out there that don't get that opportunity, that don't get to do a lot of testing even, let alone racing in lots of different cars. And it is seat time, and he's probably had more seat time than some people who've been driving for a lot of years already. And I think that makes a huge difference. You know, I think a lot of people can sympathize with me in those days when you know you're never going to get enough testing because there isn't the money behind it. You're thrown into the deep end. You've got a few laps to learn a circuit, and you know that you couldn't have done weeks and weeks and weeks of testing and racing, because it just is impossible. And he's very lucky to be in this program getting so much seat time right now.
It's everything. It's absolutely everything. Experience, experience, experience. That's what it's all about. That's the only way you're going to improve yourself a driver. That's why they've done, Nissan guys have done such a fabulous job with him. But the really good thing about it, from my perspective, I'd never met Jan Mardenwerp before this week, because I'm based in the United States these days, and I've just been really impressed with him as a person. He's humble. He's very appreciative of this opportunity. He knows that he's got the chance of a lifetime here, and that anybody else who wants to be a racing driver would give their hind teeth to be in the position he has been put. And he's humble, and he's taken. He's doing exactly with this opportunity what he should be doing with this opportunity.
Just comparing our first and second place Oak Morgans, just their different styles going down through the Forest S's there. And interestingly, we've got seven Oreca chassis running in LMP2, but none of them in the top three. We got two Oak Morgans and one Zytec chassis. So Hugh Deshonak, who's also running the Toyota program, will just be looking at that thinking, let's get one of those Oreca cars up a little bit further. But all customer cars, of course, none of them are
Trust me, they're trying. The other guys are trying, aren't they?
Yeah.
Mike Conway now in the number 26 car for Delta ADR. He's within about a minute and 10 seconds of Jan Mardenborough. Behind him, Maxime Martin in the number 46 car, the Thierry by TDS car. He is about a minute and a half behind Mike Conway. And the two leaders you were just talking about, the two Oak Racing Morgan Nissans, they are separated by about 23 seconds now. So Bertrand Baguette, who's driving the number 35 car, definitely seems to be closing in on Olivier Pla, who took the pole position in P2 on Thursday.
It was interesting watching Jan Mardenborough's in-car there coming through, and also having just watched the Toyota recently, you can see him just dropping down an extra gear into that last part of the Porsche curves where the Toyota doesn't drop down at all. They just have a little breathe, and it just goes to show how much sort of extra downforce they have and how tight the car is through there, because that's an LMP1 car going that much faster and not dropping a gear. It's just interesting for me to see sort of where the different car limits are. Just watching there, another flying car over these curvings. I think we've seen nearly every GT car catching air. Well, and there we have a flying Toyota.
Everyone except flying lizards this year. Where's the lizards when we want them?
I don't know. They've been a real great installment of Le Mans for many years. I was thinking that earlier, actually, Mark. I was thinking, where are flying lizards this year? I don't know what's happened with that program.
Of course, we've got to start thinking very, very soon about driver of the race, car of the race. I mean, Jan Mardenborough must be somewhere up there in the Eurosport cabin's choice of driver of the race.
Yeah, he's pretty far up there for me at the moment.
And how about Krohn for car of the race eventually?
Oh, I don't know.
Two-tone Krohn.
Oh, dear.
Just A for effort, certainly.
Oh, my goodness. Yeah, I think for A for effort from the team for rebuilding it, certainly.
Yeah, Mike Conway's in the reckoning as well, particularly with his retro helmet.
Definitely, yeah. I know he would be up there for me.
That's the
100%.
That's the American journalist coming out, isn't it? Yes.
What is?
Well, Mike Conway.
Well, he's English.
IndyCar driver.
Oh, yeah, see, yeah, okay.
Sorry, we're a bit.
it's been a long night.
Oh, braking completely wrong.
Talking of Oak Racing, like we were a couple of minutes ago. That's the third Oak Racing car, the Arch car. Who's driving that one at the moment?
I'm not sure, but he ignored his own.
Oh, Jacques Nicolet, the team owner. Yeah. Yes, boss.
Big lock.
Do whatever you
there
like.
For the G drive car as well. Whoa.
Well, that's Mike Conway.
Yeah, seriously hot. He was coming into that corner, wasn't he? That was Mike Conway coming up on Jan Mardenborough.
It wasn't Mardenborough.
Oh, was it not? Okay.
No. Olivier Pla has been in this car certainly for the last 2 hours. Is this going to be a driver change? Doesn't look like it, does it?
No, I don't think so. I think we're doing.
Yeah, generally, when they change tires
and
they change drivers, don't they? But not this. Well, we'll see. Actually, is that an all-black helmet?
Unless they already changed before.
It might be David Heinemeier Hansen. If it's an all-black helmet, it would be David Heinemeier Hansen.
I think you're right, Jeremy. It does look to be
the Dane who lived most of the last 10 years in Chicago, now bases himself in the south of Spain.
Here's Mike Gascoigne's charge, the Caterham Greaves car, and having all sorts of problems at the front.
Yes.
It's not had an easy run, that car, has it? A lot of problems. It had a big accident in early on in the practice this week. They managed to repanel the car, I believe they had to do, on one side, amongst other things. And now it's been struggling throughout this race. And, yeah, lots going on in here. Again, it looks like that's a suspension issue, amongst other things. I think there's a couple things going on there. Hard for us to know from our view here in the commentary box.
Yeah, here's our race leader then. Bertrand Baguette has taken over the... Bertrand Baguette is still on board the 35 car because David Heinemeier Hansen is now dropped just behind him, having had that pit stop. That'll change fairly soon, I should imagine.
And I think this car, the art car...
Nicolai's got a problem, hasn't
maybe
it?
That might be why he went off, actually, is because he's got a rear puncture. Is it? Oh, no, I don't know. Oh, no. It's very hard.
I think it must be the right rear because the looks like the left front was sort of wallowing around there.
I don't know.
It looks okay, doesn't it? Maybe it's got a suspension
but it is
problem.
I think it might be a suspension issue, which, the way it's darting back and forth, I think... Perhaps that's a rear suspension or something major, and which could be why he went off. Perhaps you were saying he missed his brake zone, but it may have been that something just broke.
Well, he missed his braking. We're going to take a break, and he's just waving cars by again. Doesn't want to be hit from behind, as you've mentioned.
Horrible. Yeah.
We'll be back after these messages here live on Eurosport from Le Mans. Retard it. Well, that's one of the shortest breaks in history. We are back looking at Jacques Nicolai, the third oldest man in the race, 57 years old. Mark Patterson, 61. And Jeremy reminding me, oh dear, Liz is just...
I thought he was about... Well,
as a driver, Liz is absolutely...
Sort of cringing at the back. He is doing a very good job. He's trying really hard not to get hit in a car that keeps leaping to the right. I'm thinking possibly that's a suspension issue. It looks that way, but... It's hard to tell, but certainly not an easy place to be right now for him, especially with an unpredictable car. There's one thing having your car too slow with a problem, then there's having it slow and unpredictable, which is really unpleasant.
Yeah. Jeremy just pointing out that, in fact, Howard Blank is the oldest driver here, was the oldest driver here at 64, and Howard had a mighty accident in the night.
Yeah, he certainly did. That was a huge... He had several offs, and that was the final one. That was the end of that one. Actually, there's another sensible aged guy in the race as well. Philip Ezebrook, very late entry. He is 58 as well, actually, from just up the road in Reims.
Jacques Nicolai's being knocked down the order.
Yes, he has. He's being shuffled back, sorry.
Here's another of his cars, sister car, the 35 car. That was Bertrand Baguette coming out, just seeing a quick replay of some of the action of the night. Most of it sleeping action. Liz?
Oh, no, I just saw a car coming into pit lane that I thought maybe had a problem, but I think he was just... pitting like normal, but oh dear, look at that.
Coyote sleeping.
Yeah.
It's funny, I was in the SRT Viper pit late last night, and there were crew guys sprawled out in all sorts of different poses all the way right across the floor on various different chairs, and I was chattering with Ryan DeYell at the time, and we were having a good chuckle looking at all these guys. That was great. But, you know, boy, any chance they get to snatch a few Zs, a catnap, if you like. It'll there you go. It's kind of waking up a bit now.
And you'll see these guys, I've seen teams where they're all asleep in their chair, but with all their radio headset on. The minute the driver's saying, I'm coming in the pits, I've got a problem, you'll see them just leap through the air because they're so primed and ready for that. And it's like battle stations. The minute there's any opportunity, here we go. Oh, dear.
That's what we saw this
same
hour.
Same car, is it? Or no, it's a different car.
Is that a replay?
No, this is the level five, and I don't think this is a replay.
No, we've got the...
kind of does that... On a regular basis, and that's just the way it is. There's unburned fuel there out of the turbos of the Honda.
It's quite special, isn't it?
It is, isn't it? Yeah. Particularly cool at night.
Well, yeah, definitely. Is this the art car finally into pit lane? Well, he'll be very happy to be coming here. We should see him in front of us.
Well done, Jack. Absolutely.
Man I worked for at one time. He has a television production company in Monaco, amongst many of his attributes. He's an entrepreneur of great... multi-talents and very, very genial Frenchman, Jack, and good job he's done. Bought the Pescarello team, of course, and that then morphed into Ocron, which is now based here at Le Mans in the old Pescarello premises. Henri Pescarello, as we saw, driving the pace car at the start of the race, and is in the next door cabin with our Eurosport France colleagues. Not right now, but he has been over the weekend. So Henri will not lie down.
No, we've heard noises about Henri trying to come back to Le Mans with the team. We don't know yet if he'll be able to pull that all together, but wouldn't we all love to see him back here with the Pescarello? Yep. That would be wonderful. And a really big French fan. The French have always supported Pescarello.
Yep.
So, yeah, just seeing the art car here pushing in, hopefully we'll be able to see what's actually happened there. But I suspect it's a suspension issue.
Yeah, it's so heavy of all these road signs all over it that it's...
Oh dear, Mark.
Dear. Actually, just
more sleep needed, I think.
Yeah. Talking to Jacques Nicolet, one of the co-drivers is Jean-Marc Merlin, who, happy birthday to him, by the way. He celebrates today his 49th birthday.
Oh, excellent.
Making his
birthday.
Le Mans debut this season.
It's a good way to celebrate your birthday,
yeah,
isn't it?
Yeah, not bad at all. Yeah, he's basically a vintage car racer. I'd never heard the name. Well, not heard much. He's raced various different vintage cars. He had a Lola T70. He's got the old ADA Porsche 962C. He's got various other classic cars as well, which he owns, and educated actually in North America too. So he's a bit of a citizen of the world. So happy birthday, Jean-Marc Merlin. Sorry to see your car, or the car you're sharing with Jacques Nicolet and Philippe Mondelot, another Le Mans rookie, in trouble now.
Well, we've had on Twitter, Real Racing Roots has told us that Flying Lizards are still in ALMS.
Yep.
Going GTC this season, waiting for the 991 GT3 RSR customer program. So thank you very much for that. And
thank
also, Robert Greasley, we're just giving a shout out to your four-year-old son, Rupert, because he's up and asking why he yawns a lot, which is, he'll get used to that after a few more years of Le Mans, I'm sure.
I mean, will anyone ever replace the Lizards here? The catapult launched hats flying into the crowd. I mean, that is one of the abiding images of the Lizards' visits.
And the poor Lizards always having quite a tough run of Le Mans. They seem to have this horrible black cloud that sits over them at Le Mans. And every year we think, surely they'll do better this time. But
they always seem to, finally.
But they had a lot of. It seemed to almost every year have something horrible go wrong.
Pits off for the race leader, car number two, Tom Christensen, brings the Audi R18 e-tron Quattro into the pits. Fuel only and away he goes. Boy, that was a quick
very
stop.
Very quick, yeah. Change of the water bottle for Tom Christensen as well.
Just about a minute pits up, less than that, 58 seconds from the line at the entry to pit lane to the line at the exit of the pit lane, 58 seconds. That's a very good stop. 58 seconds. We don't see many stops quicker than that.
And Reinhold, yes, we just saw there, still hands on after all these years. He was a Le Mans driver himself. He won Le Mans so many times with the lucky number 7 with his Porsches. He has actually got a painting hanging at home in the attic, and that gets older as he stays the same age.
Nice to see him still here. Everybody looking a little bit sleepy this time in the morning, and I'm sure that we all look the same. I reckon I've aged about 5 years just overnight.
So Christophe Bourret now taking over the 76 car. Vernet's done his bit in the Matmut Porsche. Quite a short stint, actually. I think Sean Coligny did one stint there.
He'd have done
more than that, for sure.
Must have done. No, well, I would say most teams are doing at least three stints.
When we came on, Raymond Nerac was on board. Jean Carbonet took it over, and now Christophe Bourret is shown as in that 76 car. We've only been on for 2 hours, so...
How interesting. I wonder why that is, because at this stage in the race, in the early morning when it's this cool, because it is very cool outside, isn't it, Jeremy Shaw? You would expect to see most teams doing 3, 4... maybe even 5 if the Audis are still being that brave. Well, it's cool. I'm guessing they're probably down to 4 stints now, but certainly not a single.
He certainly had a long stint overnight, and one of the regulations here is you're not allowed to do more than 4 hours behind the wheel within a 6-hour period.
Yep.
So it could be something to do with that.
But they wouldn't have put him in, surely, then. You know, that's what I'm saying, is you would have thought if he'd done a long stint like that, the next two drivers would have done quite long stints. It wouldn't have come upon his time yet within that 6-hour period.
The more time he spends behind the wheel of that car, the farther ahead it's going to get, because he is the quickest guy in GTE AM. It would appear, at least
needs some car time to get to qualify. There is a maximum of 14 hours. Is there a minimum that a driver must drive to be classified.
I believe it's 4 hours.
Yep.
Am I correct?
So maybe Bray missed out the night and...
Maybe.
Who knows?
Oh, who knows? We're all just speculating now.
Mark Patterson then holds the record this year for the most spins in one lap, and that was at the start of practice on Wednesday night when the rain came down.
And, yeah, he admitted that was a real eye-opener because it was horrendous conditions and you know, he'd never driven here before and, oh, yeah... That was a scary session for Mark. But, you know, to his credit, I mean, he really focused himself and has done a fantastic job for somebody who's 61 years of age. He does drive a lot, of course, these days. He's driven in the Rolex Grand Am Series in Daytona Prototypes for several years. He's been racing over here in several years in FIA GT3 cars, amongst other things. So he's got plenty of experience. He drove his first prototype, Le Mans prototype race at Petit Le Mans last year, so yeah, lots of experience, but boy, he's really done a super job. He really takes this seriously.
And I think those conditions would have been difficult for anybody, really, especially a Le Mans rookie. So, you know, we will let him off a little bit there, and especially in a prototype car. I mean, it is really tricky.
Spinning is no problem, as long as you don't hit anything.
Yeah, he managed not to hit anything.
Yeah, Jacques Villeneuve, his first ever Grand Prix, or in preparation for his first ever Grand Prix at Silverstone 1977, he spun on every single corner during his first day of practice in the McLaren. And everybody said, boy, this guy's completely wild and out of control. Well, he was just he said afterwards, yeah, I was just learning the limits of the coach. The usual French Canadian Gaelic shrug. I'm just
exploring
the
limits.
And you know, and he was. Yeah. I mean, that wasn't BS from Gilles. That's what he was doing. He was exploring the limits of the car, finding them, overstepping them, because you don't know how fast you can go until you get to that limit.
We just went back to
It takes a lot of guts to do that.
We just went back to the Oak Racing car of Jack Nicolay, and it looks like they're replacing a steering rack. So,
okay. Yeah. Well, that makes sense with the darting around as well, doesn't it? So, and I wonder, it didn't look like he'd hit anything or anything, and maybe it just failed, but.
Two of the three Audis then running together. We're on board the number three car. That's Luca De Grassi, and just ahead of him is race leader Tom Christensen, who is two laps down the road. Two laps, 1 minute 41 seconds. And Tom, little lock up there, going into the Forza chicane, the first one.
Maybe feeling a little bit of pressure from the number three car right behind him.
Well, Luca would like to unlap himself, I think. And remember, another Le Mans rookie, Luca De Grassi, despite the fact he has had huge success, hasn't he? And he won Sao Paulo for Audi last autumn, race we showed live on Eurosport.
Yeah, and talented guy. He got a brief opportunity in Formula One. Won races in GP2 before that, and all the way up the ladder. So, you know, plenty of talent there, and good to see him get this opportunity. Yeah, he's the only one. There's 41 rookies in the race. We talked about that several times during the event, but he's the only rookie in the P1 class.
Yeah, remember, he raced in Formula One, 24 Grand Prix. Can you remember which team that was with?
I do not, but Jeremy probably does.
Yeah, it was with...
Virgin.
Yes, right.
There's a name to catch
now. Marussia, yeah.
That's not often you would see a Le Mans rookie in the Audi, is there? No. You know, it seems like, I don't know, I feel like all those drivers have been going forever in that car, but I suppose they've got to bring him in at some stage, don't they?
I think Jeremy made the point last night. This is one of the drivers they really, really want to bring on there. This is the future. Tom and Alan won't be around forever. You know, there's going to come a time when they want to say, you know, that's enough, like Dindo Capello and Manuele Pirro.
Yeah, absolutely.
And Frank Bieler, indeed.
No, he'll certainly be one to watch for the future, that's for sure.
Again, that depends how long Audi is here. A lot of rumours flying around this weekend that when Porsche come in, which is part of the Audi group, maybe Audi will only have 1 year racing against them and might look at something else. Who knows?
Yeah, and I guess a parting of the ways that the head of the Audi, or the VW Audi group, Motorsports... the group motorsports director for VW Audi Group, who is?
The board member, Wolfgang Dürheimer.
Right.
He left the company just before Le Mans.
Right.
We won't expand on that, but it was...
Why?
He was due to be the key speaker here at the Audi press conference, and on his 55th birthday, he parted ways with Audi.
Yeah. Mm. Very interesting. Purple sector, always like looking at purple sector times. For Marcel Fessler in car number one, still fighting his way up the field. And Fessler, he's gone up into seventh place now. He's passed the Straka HPD. Number three car coming into the pit lane. One more time.
23rd or 24th time into the pits for car number three, the same as a number two car. The two Toyotas, they've only been into the pit lane 21 times so far. They'll be owing us a stop fairly soon, actually, as I say that. Alex Wirtz is just rejoining. Three fewer stops for the Toyotas, but still the best of them a lap behind the overall race leader.
And then look at the Rebellions, Jeremy, 19 and 20 pit stops respectively. They're getting so much distance out of their fuel loads, got extra 3 litres like the Toyota factory car has, and making the most of it.
Great to see them doing so well in this race. I don't want to give them the curse of the commentator, but it's fantastic that they're sort of nipping at the heels and waiting for anything to happen. I think that's what they said early on in the race when we were down in the pits. They said, well, we'll be here, hopefully waiting for something to go wrong. And they certainly are there. They're in the hunt. They're up there with the P1 cars. And you never know. Something could happen.
So this, here we go. This is the moment we just saw as the Audi came in. Look at that crowding going into the Dunlop chicane.
Yeah,
great stuff.
Looks like one of those Porsches being ushered off. Here it is. It's number... that's the...
Well, that was tight.
It's number 80, number 77 car, I think that was actually. No, it was the 88 car with the silver shade band across the windscreen. One of the Proton competition run cars. Ushered off into the gravel almost. He just about managed to get it out, didn't he? Nice job, actually.
I was lucky, very lucky indeed.
And that was Max Martin going out just in front of the Audi. That was a nice little bit of filming. And look at how quickly he gets away. The Audi just slightly slower getting off.
Yeah, that number 88 car, Christian Reed driving that car now. That was very much in contention for the win in GTE Am until, I don't know, a couple of hours or so ago. It's now down to about eighth or ninth place in the class. But the 88 car, along with the 77, Patrick Dempsey at the wheel of that one still at the moment, having just made a pit stop, they were dicing for the lead along with the 76 car.
Well, I've double shifted and I'm about to leave you. Carlton Kirby's back in the cabin and I will see you. I'm going to leave him with
and
you
I'm
too.
I'm leaving as
and
well.
See you soon. Okay, Liz.
See
on a break.
Ya. Bye.
We're back with Eurosport Live at Le Mans. We're just coming up the 7 hours to go mark. It's nearly 8 o'clock in the morning here. The great race will finish at 3 this afternoon. Hope you've got your coffee, croissants like we have, and just relax back and enjoy the action. It's Audi leading overall. Tom Christensen, Alan McNish and Luca de Grassi are there. So not Luca de Grassi. Falling over myself now, not Duval. And they leave P1. P2 led by the Oak Racing Morgan of Bertrand Baguet in Pro GTE. It's Bruno Senna leading. Yeah, Bruno Senna, you heard that right. A Le Mans rookie from Porsche and from Peter Dumbreck. And in GTM, it is Raymond Marac's car, the IMSA Performance Porsche of Christophe Bourret. Carlton Kirby will be joining us in just a moment, and Jeremy Shaw's alongside me, and so too is Damien Faulkner. Damien, welcome back.
Good morning. Good to be here. Now, where are those croissants?
we just ate them. You're just 10 seconds too late. So, Damien, you've had a wander around the paddock on the way back in, just seeing what's going on? Or?
No, I'm afraid we just came straight here. So missed a little bit of
we're
the action.
Dropping at the deep end, yeah.
Got some sleep, which is nice.
Probably during the night, we had eight safety cars are up to now. We had rain during the night, those of you just joining us. There was quite a long stoppage. Howard Blank crashed his Ferrari very heavily, punched a hole in the barriers, and that meant that they had to have another safety car over a long time. This has been a problem over the weekend. The Armco taking such a battering here, not just during the race, but during practice and qualifying.
Yeah, and the trouble is it takes so long to repair it, you know. That's one of the difficulties, isn't it, with the Armco barrier, getting the machinery down there to it, and getting all those nuts and bolts off, and then obviously replacing the panels with new ones. So we saw a big crash actually before we retired last night with the number 30 HVM status car. Huge crash, but that was against the wall. So in actual fact, the stoppage wasn't too bad at all.
Right, we're riding on board with Richard Leitz at the moment. This is the Manti Racing Porsche, factory Porsche. This is the all-new Singing Dancing 991, the one which has now got wishbone front suspension rather than McPherson struts. It's got the radiators moved. It's much, much lower. And here we are, problem here for the 47 car. This is Alex Imperati in the number 47 Morgan. This is a car we were talking up just a few minutes ago, and they're being pushed into the garage. He took it over from Matt Howson and Ho Ping Tung. This is the Chinese car in effect. There we are, bang on 8 o'clock in the morning, 7 o'clock at home if you're just waking up. Richard Leitzen and Bruno Senna swapping places every lap in GT Pro. This has been a real feature battle.
Yeah, that's been a fantastic battle. That's been going on for a long, long time. In fact, the last stint that I did last night, and long, long before that, the stint before that as well. So, yeah, that's really exciting and a good proper battle for honours in the GTE Pro class. You've got Richard Leitz taking that, as you say, over from Bruno Senna at the moment, with Peter Dumbreck further back in third, and then Timo Bernhard for Porsche in fourth place in that category.
Right, well, next to us is joining us Anthony Reid. Anthony, good morning. You've had a busy weekend. You were driving Mike Hawthorne's car in the Legends race yesterday morning. Can you just switch Anthony on? Thank you.
Hi.
Yesterday morning.
That's about it.
And Anthony, I mean, of course, a lot of us remember your Group C performances here, so you've been a long-time Le Mans racer.
Yeah, I mean, I've driven a lot of different cars, a great range of cars. I mean, from the MG LMP 675, which is incredibly quick, and we actually did battle with the Audis and ran as high as third before the car broke down. Driving Mike Hawthorne's D-Type yesterday, the 1955 Le Mans winner. What a famous car. There is only one of those cars on the planet, and I was driving it yesterday. How lucky am I?
How did the race go for you?
These cars, it's not like modern sports car racing where the cars are incredibly reliable. There's been very few retirements over the 24-hour race this weekend. It's all about reliability with these old cars, and the D-Type, we had problems with the head gasket in qualifying, so I only qualified seventh. I made one lap in qualifying, and then in the race, made a great start, got up to third place, had a big battle with the sister car, Gary Pearson, in another D-Type, the Maserati, and of course Buncombe, who got a little bit of he got away at the start as we fell over each other, but it was just sensational. I mean, just racing those valuable cars, priceless cars, wheel to wheel. It was great fun in tricky conditions.
Oh, conditions are horrible, weren't they?
Yeah,
absolutely horrible.
I just love it because that's what Le Mans is all about. It's like a close-range knife fight for 24 hours.
You know, Jeremy behind you is doing great arm-locking movements.
I love the oversteer.
How do you park those thoughts of this being the only car on the planet when you had a fantastic first lap yesterday coming through the field?
You know what we racing drivers are like. When you get in the car, all of that goes out the window. You just want to race and have fun and win.
You do, Anthony. I mean, one of the standout drives for me of classic racing for years, it must have been 3 years ago, 4 years ago at the Silverstone Classic, you had the Acela in that evening race, and it was one of the finest performances I've ever seen.
Yes, the LMP, Lola T290, yeah.
Yeah, sorry, just going to interrupt for a second. Is this the 98 card? It's limping around.
It's got a puncture.
Rear puncture.
Left rear. That's right rear.
Yeah, this is, of course, Roland Goethe was on board that car. No, it's... Which one is that? That's the...
The thing about Le Mans, and you can't really see that on television, is the scale...
Bill Oberlin.
The scale of the track. It's so long. Yeah. If you get a puncture at the back of the circuit, it's a real battle to get the car back. It's not like driving around Silverstone, you're back in the pits within a minute. You know, it can take you 15 minutes to get the car back to the pits if you've got a puncture or some other mechanical problem.
You've mentioned some of the cars you've driven here. I remember the Group C Porsche performance you had. I mean, what was your favourite car here?
Quite a few of them. I mean, racing a Ferrari, I forget exactly what it was in 2005. The Le Mans Porsche 962 is probably my favourite because we ended up on the podium. We were operating out of what I call the Steve McQueen pits. You know, it was before this big building was built. Yeah. And there weren't proper pit garages. There were pit boxes. The pit lane was incredibly narrow. the pit signalers couldn't make the signalling from the pit wall here. Signalling was done from Mulsanne Corner. So when you pass the pits, somebody then, you know, who'd taken your lap time would have to wind up the black telephone in each of the pit boxes and signal, you know, give the message through to the signalling area at Mulsanne Corner, and that's where you got your lap time. It was so atmospheric. 962 doing 225 miles an hour on the Mulsanne Straits. It's difficult to see past that. I mean, it was just such a great experience and my first time at Le Mans.
Brilliant, brilliant. Now, we've got, of course, the Silverstone Classic coming up in two or three weeks' time. Are you going to be there again?
Yes. I'm very fortunate to drive for Nigel Webb. He's a great Mike Hawthorn enthusiast. Also has many Jaguars. He's got a museum in the grounds of his car. A museum in the grounds of his house, and has about 20 Jaguars. He's got a library upstairs which has all the provenance of the cars, the history, full-time, you know, full-blown workshop next door, and I drive many of his cars. So next, you know, the Silverstone Classic, I'm going to be driving the D-Type. He's got an E-Type that was raced by Salvadorian period, and possibly a Mark II Jaguar.
Excellent. So, we've got a safety car, Anthony. This is the ninth safety car, I think, Jeremy will confirm, of the race so far. The eighth one was for Howard Blanc during the evening when he punched the rail. Can you see? Oh, it's oil on track, that's why. And that, it wasn't a puncture. That's a, it's an oil problem for that Bill Orbelin.
That must have been blue smoke
Aston
then.
Martin. Yeah, yeah. It looked like the cockpit was full of smoke as well, didn't it, when he stopped?
He's and, parked down there at Mulsanne Corner there.
Yeah, so he has dropped. That oil is on the entry to the second chicane that we've been given the light on. So Anthony, you're wearing a Goodwood Festival of Speed hat as well. So, I mean, you've raced at Goodwood in the revival, haven't you, as well as
Raced
Speed in the Festival.
Beautiful cars. I'm also the reigning king of the hill of the Goodwood Festival of Speed, winning in for Chevron last year in front of all the major car manufacturers, which was, for me, was one of the highlights of last season. But the revival is a very special event, as you well know, and I've driven a whole range of cars. They have priceless cars, Ferrari 250 short wheelbase, the D-Type Jaguar, E-Type, a Shelby Cobra last year. I was leading the Cobra, the special Cobra special celebration race by 10 seconds and got a black flag for having a problem with the exhaust. And we still finished on the podium. And, you know, very special, that Shelby Cobra. And the previous evening, I'd had supper with Cleo Shelby, that's Shelby's wife, at the house at Goodwood, and she was regaling me with some great stories about the history of the car.
And wonderful. And again, yesterday we enjoyed seeing the Wilmot Cobra and the Cobra Daytona Coupe in your race, in the Legends race.
Yeah, the Daytona Cobra, it's a very special car. That there are only 10 in existence. Six original, and that one that you saw racing yesterday was actually built out of a standard Shelby Cobra some years ago. So it's not entirely original, but still a very special car.
Of course, Peter Brock, of course, designed that on the back of an envelope over lunch, didn't he, when Carol Shelby said, I need a quicker Cobra. And Peter Brock has been here many, many years at Le Mans. Not this year. We haven't seen him this year, so I guess he's decided to take a holiday for a year. Anthony Reid, thank you very much for joining us. Carlton Kirby is ready to come back into the chair. And all the best at the Goodwood Festival and at the Goodwood Hill Climb.
Thank you. Looking forward to it. And thanks for inviting me this morning.
Good. Cheers. Anthony Reid, thank you very much indeed. So, just trying to clear some of this oil debris of the Aston Martin of Bill Orbelin. Just if you're just joining us, the 98 car has been out of the running for some time of in the top places. But Hugh de Schoenach there, overseeing the Toyota program, working together with Toyota Germany on the Japanese car. And Bill Orbelin knows he's not going to go any further.
No, but is he plugging in his radio talk to the team, to ask the team something, or is he trying to disconnect it?
Yeah, the rule is you don't go more than 5 meters from the car, else it's considered to be abandoned. So as long as you stay within the close proximity of the car with the radio on. And Carlton is about to leap into my seat, and he's never looked more wonderful on a Sunday morning.
And while you two change over, just a quick note about Anthony Reid, and, you know, people
I get a lot of questions. You know, how do I get to become a racing driver? And my answer is, how hard do you want to work? We're going to go to a I could probably get this in before the commercial break. But how hard do you want to work? Anthony Reid, for 3 years, worked on the oil fields up in the Shetland Islands, living in a tent and just earning as much money as he could. It was hard work to earn the money. Came back and put his money into a racing career. Derek Daly, the father of Connor Daly, who's currently running one of the front runners in GP3, he worked for 18 months in Australia in an iron ore mine. Yeah. Absolutely right. Hard labour. He and a fellow Dubliner, David Kennedy, and both of those two, Derek Daly and David Kennedy, both made it to Formula One. That's how hard they wanted to become racing drivers.
They both went to Australia together as well, didn't they?
Yes, they did. Yeah, and spent 18 months down the road. Came back with enough money to buy themselves each a Formula Ford car, made all the way to Formula One. Also, if you're trying to become a racing driver, a great resource for you to go to is www.safeisfast.com. It's a website that's been put together by the Road Racing Drivers Club in North America, and it's supported by the FIA Motorsports Institute, Safety Institute. So it's a great website. Alexander Wurz has been a contributor to that, amongst others, in this motor race. There's a whole bunch of instructional videos about techniques, about how to find sponsorship, about how to work on your fitness, about safety. It's a tremendous website, and there's also question and answer sessions on there. Ask a Pro. Ben Edwards, the Formula One commentator for BBC, is this week's Ask a Pro. You can send in your questions via safeisfast.com. We're going to go to a quick commercial break, and we'll be back. Don't go away. Back with you again. My name is Jeremy Shaw. Alongside me, as has been for the last hour or so, Damien Faulkner. Joining us in the booth, Mr. Carlton Kirby. And we are under yellow here. The eighth caution period, I think, of the race.
Jeremy,
still nothing changed at the front.
An hour ago, I was sleeping.
Yeah,
I've just joined 10 minutes ago.
Is that all it was?
Yeah.
Seems like it forever, David.
The teddy bear tells you everything you need to know.
It took Carlton just a while longer.
Yeah, absolutely. It's been a long old night. Thank you for your company if you were with us through the night, and give yourself a little medal if that was the case. The cleanup's still going on. Do you know what? I've lost count. I thought this was the ninth caution, but anyway.
Is it? Well, I might have missed one.
This was one overnight. Probably. Well, I've been dogged with them.
I thought it was the eighth, but it could be the ninth. Talking of people tuning in and staying up, a couple of shout-outs from Twitter here. Ken Chia is currently watching live from Malaysia. Great to have you with us, Ken. A nomination for the driver of the race, which we were talking about a few minutes ago, all the Aston Martin drivers, says Aid and Indy the Dog. Yes, nice name. Great suggestion, because the Aston Martin guys have done a fantastic job under horrendously difficult circumstances. Patrick O'Brien, can I have a shout-out, please? Been watching in Ireland since 2 o'clock yesterday and pulled an all-nighter to watch Eurosport. What do you think about that, Damien Faulkner?
Yeah, well, I wonder if he's related to Arthur Doyle, because he's up all night as well. He's just tweeted in, and another guy has tweeted in here, to ask the question, when the Audi pits, the driver aid plugs a wire into the side of the driver's seat, and he wants to know, what is that for?
Downloading the data from the onboard system. They get the live telemetry beamed back to the pits in real time as the car is going around the racetrack, but there's also there's only so much data they can transfer electronically while the car is in motion. So they plug in that computer wire to download all the data from that last stint, since its last pit stop, so the data engineers can analyze that as soon as the car leaves the pit lane. Somebody here is suggesting that staying up pretty much all night has made me sound a bit croaky. Guess that's probably the case. No, I haven't been on the cheap lager. Wish I had. But thanks for your comments. Philip Lane asks, will we see DP cars from the Grand Am series in Le Mans in the next few years as a result of the merger of Grand Am and American Le Mans series? That's a very good question, to which we do not know the answer. There's certainly been some there's going to be a lot of changes next year in sports car racing in the United States with the amalgamation of those two series. I am involved in the American Le Mans series, fortunate enough to do the television coverage of that. Hopefully I'll be doing it next year as well, fingers crossed. Where that will leave those cars in relation to Le Mans, yet to be determined.
Do you know
I'll tell you what, though, it'll keep us a lot... They're loud, those things. They are loud.
Very, very much so. Do you know, it's amazing. Endurance racing is experiencing some kind of renaissance at the moment. People are actually getting into it. We had a lot of people yesterday, as we just watched the Corvettes replay of that incident. A lot of people are actually saying that they're new to it, they've come to it, they really, really enjoy it, and absolutely hooked. Had a couple overnight who were expanding on the attractiveness of the sport. I think if you make it live and you realise what it's all about, all of a sudden something does click with endurance racing. And whereas you might have thought 24 hours, I couldn't possibly. Well, actually, it kind of flies by. And especially when it's been as busy and more busy than that poor gentleman who's clearly just about reached the end of his tether. Dormarie Cox says, great coverage, guys. Had an all-night, but confess, I did actually accidentally snooze off in the middle of it. I presume you were dreaming about us, Dormarie Cox, at the same time, just to stay in touch, sort of metaphorically, if you like.
Yes. Jake says he's not impressed apparently with the balance performance rules in in GT, and he says that they didn't pay as much as Aston or Porsche. I'm not quite sure who he's talking about there because I missed the earlier threads on that one. But you know, if he's talking about the fact there's only two marks in contention at the front of this field, the two Aston Martins and the two Porsches. The main reason for that, Jake, is because of the that initial first full course caution at the beginning of the race. That split the field. Three cars were able to pull away by a third of a lap from everybody else because of the way the three pace cars are run here at Le Mans. So my criticism is not with the balance of performance. I think they've got that pretty close. Yes, the Astons might have a slight advantage here, but hey, generally speaking, it's pretty close between all of the marks involved in GT racing. I think, given the fact the cars are so different, I love the fact that they made them pretty close, and certainly if you look at the lap times, there's not a lot to choose between them. And it was just that fact that those cars were split away from the rest, and there was another caution later on that split them even farther away. So that's the main reason there's only the Astons and the Porsches dicing for the lead in GT.
Damien Fortner, it's been great to have you on board this year.
Thank you. Thank you.
I'm hoping that your smiley face means that you've actually very much enjoyed this, or you, and that you haven't got any other kind of problems lingering.
Well, yeah, I have enjoyed it, and I promise I haven't been talking to any teams about driving here next year.
Because
I want to be back here next year, here with you guys.
It's almost been like an open application his entire time here, which is great. So, it's been good to have you on board, and we're back now for a solid session into the rest of the morning. Can you believe there's still more than 6 hours and 40 minutes remaining of this race? It's hard to get your head around, and in fact, it's about now, isn't it, where you get to breakfast time that you start thinking as a driver, what?
Yeah, I mean, it's, you know, they wake up and the guys who have, the drivers who've been asleep will wake up now, they'll be tired, but you know, they just have to get on with the job. There's only less than 7 hours left. That's not a lot of time, because you know, they're going through their rota system, and so they're just going to be, as Carlton's choking here beside me.
Yeah, that's doesn't sound good. There's one of the Corvettes down there, car number 73. They had some problems earlier on. Jan Magnussen shown at the wheel of that car, running in 7th, 8th place in the GT class, just behind the sister car of Tommy Milner. And if our last respondent on Twitter was talking about the relative competitors of the Chevrolets, yeah, they've been taken a bit by surprise here this weekend. They're going actually not quite as quickly as they went last year. So although they've made some developments on the car, they're not quite on the pace they were last year. I spoke to Doug Feehan, the program manager, yesterday about that, and he said, you know, last year's lap times here really weren't representative, he claimed, because they got toes, aerodynamic drafts on each of the long straights here, and so those toes are able to go, cars go quicker than they might otherwise have done. Well, they have an opportunity to get toes this year. Frank, quite honestly, the cars aren't quite as quick as they were last year, and they don't really know why. They've got a little bit more weight on those cars than they're originally planning to run, but the Chevy's just, they've missed the mark a little bit this race.
There's a sad side. Bill Oberlin phoning America, phoning home.
Yeah, he's stranded out at the far end of the Mulsanne, isn't he?
Well, we've seen so much in terms of how you ride your luck out there. I've got to say that I'm delighted to come back in and see Toyotas 2 and 3 at the moment, and the best of them, the Sarazan car number 8 at the moment, just a lap behind. And you never know what might happen, but, Alan McNish was talking about how the ease or whatever of when he won and how he almost felt like the first one was something of a gift, and then he wanted to repeat the feat. He's going for his treble, of course, and Tom Christensen, well, it is an endless list of victory. These guys, hugely experienced, and I think they're riding that. They know every inch of this circuit, and they're using it to very good effect. They're going to need all their wile and guile to bring home the big prize, because Toyota, surprise to me, are absolutely knocking on the door at the moment. The number one car has been amazing as well. It's up to sixth now. That was down into 23rd place, I think, at one point, Jeremy.
Yeah, it was certainly a long way down, and it's still, how many laps behind is it? 11 laps behind, which is about what it was when they had that long problem to change the alternator on that Audi R18 e-tron Quattro. A couple of other Twitter notes here. APH Motorsports, does the safety car give leaders the chance to bunch up? Well, sort of, except for the fact there's three safety cars here at Le Mans. So, unfortunately, they don't bunch up all together. They bunch up behind three different safety cars, which I've been ranting about that consistently through this race. In fact, the last several years that I've been here, fortunate enough to come here, I think that's, to me, I don't like the safety car system. I think they perhaps should bunch up the field, at least before they go back to green. It just gives, for me, it gives a better show for the fans. I mean, that's why we're here. We're not racing for ourselves. The drivers aren't racing for themselves. The teams aren't racing for themselves. We're racing for the 250,000 people that come here to watch, and the countless knows how many millions watch on television around the world. So I think that would provide a better show, but that's just me.
Yes, it is a window that we have here on Eurosport into 28 million homes, let's not forget. And that's a massive audience. I think you're absolutely right, Jeremy. It is about the show. The excuse, if there is one, is that it's such a vast circuit that you have three cars just to sort of neutralise the field. But, yeah, I know what you mean. It would be nice to just see them racing right from the get-go. I suppose it allows for a shorter safety car period, with all of the trio just running between the various zones and peeling off at the next one. But I haven't really witnessed that, and I'm kind of in your camp on this one, I've got to say. Damien, your thoughts?
Yeah, it probably... because the track is so long, I think that's probably part of the reason. And it gets the car slowed down much faster. Because it's such a vast area, it's 8.5 miles of all over the place here. And so... pardon me, the cars will have, if there's the more safety cars, the quicker the cars are going to find one, and so it slows them down, and it probably protects the incident and the marshals at that incident, whatever that may be, a little bit better. That may be one of the reasons.
I think that's exactly the reason, yeah, that they have three safety cars here, and I think that's a very good reason. However, in this day and age, with all the telemetry and the electronics on these cars, race control, the information, the drivers should be... That's why you have double yellow flags. You slow right down for double yellow flags, and there's all sorts of systems that could be brought in, introduced into these cars, that would alert anybody in race control to anybody who's going too fast through a specific zone. It would take a bit of education, no doubt about it, but I think it could be done, because if there's an incident on the track, you know, 98% of the track is clear. It's just the area around the incident where you want to make sure that the speeds are properly maintained.
Well, they could actually do something, you know, like... When the incident is clear, or the driver is gone and they're just sweeping up, or right, whatever, they could get rid of
exactly
one or two of them.
Absolutely.
And have them all bunch up together.
I think so. That wouldn't take much more time.
No.
Anyhow.
Just an idea.
there we go.
We know everything, so we can fix absolutely anything.
You know what I don't know is how the fans do it, especially when there's a gale blowing and indeed the rain's hammering down and you happen to be in a summer tent because that's all you bought, 15 quid from your local supermarket. But they come here, they remain cheery. It's absolutely fantastic. And the grandstands are starting to fill with those looking slightly the worse for wear. They are our friends. Let's not forget that. And they are what this sport is all about. It's marvellous.
Yeah, it is. And for one or two or three of them, perhaps a little bit of alcohol might play a bit of a role in
maybe
that.
Not that friendly, yeah.
A note from the number 32 Lotus T128. Boy, the Lotus teams Lotus Praga teams had a difficult week. But that car has finally been retired. Terminal clutch problems, we are told. So I think that will be the 8th retirement from the race. And we talked about a little earlier on, the record for the fewest retirements from the 24 Hours of Le Mans is 16. We're currently at 8 with 6.5 hours to go.
And I just got a tweet from Adam. He said, you even asked for a drive with Murphy prototype on air.
He did.
Damn right I did. He owes me now.
It was, the whole interview went along the lines of, why didn't you call me? I'm here for you. Why aren't you here for me? Have that for an impersonation.
Very good. you don't ask, you don't get.
Of course, I don't ask enough. That's part of my problem. Yeah, that's why I only race 12 times a year at the moment.
I felt like the ugly partner of the girls. You know, I was a...
I
better leave. You know, I just went round the corner. I went round the corner while the love-in got... No. at least you've made a mark. There we are.
Well, I think so. He knows who I am.
Cameraman's paid his...
I know who he's, he is as
he's
well.
Paid his €4. It looks like he's the only one on there. Well, have we got a fixed camera on that thing? I don't think so. It'd be a very cheap special effect instead of using a helicopter, I guess, if we did have a lock-off there. Find your peace where you can, I think, is the message from that gentleman. Still local, Yannis. And is there a human being there?
There is. He's got a yellow bib there. Is that a photographer's bib?
And that's what he's seeing, yes, precisely.
Oh, fantastic.
There's some fantastic pictures we've had over the last 18 hours here. Just tremendous, tremendous camera work here. Somebody's really thinking about it. We can see the camera actually on the Ferris wheel across from us here at the Ford chicane, our vantage point here. Note also from the pit lane, the number 12 Rebellion Lola has been in the pits for about 10 minutes. We'll try and find out why that would be. It's dropped it down now to 8th place, and it is a couple of laps behind the Stracker car.
A couple of people asking overnight as to why there are a number of various different helmets, ice hockey helmets, bicycle helmets. Well, basically, you are required to wear head protection as a member of the crew, a disco ball as well. We did have Earth, Wind and Fire last night. Did I mention that before? You take whatever's comfortable, I guess. If you're not in a particular fire zone, it is a work area. If you're going to be in there, you need head protection. Even the pit lane reporters in the past have been required to wear them, although I think Liz has managed to eschew that, which is...
No, because we have to wear the headsets.
Yes, exactly.
With the antenna, it's a little bit difficult.
Yes, and the answer to the basic helmet question, why is there such a diversity? I think it's whatever you're comfortable in within the rules. It's as simple as that. Something light and airy.
Yeah, the helmets have to pass certain protection minimums. And someone asked me yesterday whether there's any difference between that drivers wear, whether they're in open cockpit cars or closed cockpit cars. The answer to that is no. They have to wear the same very high-spec helmets.
Very much so, with high-impact visors, I've got to tell you as well. I don't want any gravel getting in the way. Welcome back. We are about to go racing once again. The safety car announcement has been made. They will be in at the end of this lap. So one more. Good warning as well. They get an entire sort of sighting lap before the restart, which is extraordinarily useful. The track looks extremely clean, I've got to tell you. The marshals, of which there are apparently around 300 here, doing a great job. Not suggesting they've all got a broom, but the course looks clean and tidy. You see the just beyond the hashed white lines there, you see a lot of marbles that have been spat clear. I imagine the most of the track clearing has been done by the cars themselves, Damien.
Yeah, well, certainly the racing line will have a clean line, basically. But offline, there'll still be a lot of marbles. And they'll stay there until such time as they're swept up by someone long after the race.
Jeremy, did you see who's stacked up here behind this? Just how crucial is this restart going to be here for Toyota, for example?
Well, they're still trying to claw back the lap deficit to Tom Christensen, so they're just going to hope that Tom Christensen gets involved in some sort of incident while he's trying to work his way through the field. I don't know who is where, to be perfectly honest, in relation to which safety car.
There's the two car of Tom Christensen.
All right, and, okay.
Which is four cars back behind this lead safety car, by the looks of things. I'm just trying to get for which
number. That's
which,
number seven Toyota there with the red mirrors on the car.
That's the least threatening one to Tom Christensen. Yeah. The eight Sarrazin car would be more important for Christensen to distance himself from.
The number seven car is three cars away from being lapped for a second time.
Right.
Both Toyotas are actually one lap down to the leaders, but as you can see, that Alex Wurz in car number seven is unless he can really put his foot down, he's going to be lapped for a second time shortly.
As if by magic, suddenly we hook up with the eight car that's on the back of this little train. Now, the important action here then may well come from Wurz, who could do a good blocking job. I'm not suggesting he's going to do anything illegal, but it'd be good for him to hold up Christensen and maybe just give Sarrazin a chance to pass by and get on with the job at hand. We speculate. We'll find out the answer to those questions in just a short while. So the action will be within this line. There we are. You heard it clearly from our race director. Yellow revolving lights to be extinguished. And then, as soon as they have their opportunity, they will get up to speed and depart.
I love this communication from the race director. That's really cool.
He's got this very much Dr. Evil sound
great,
about
isn't
him. He's up there somewhere. I'd love to know what kind of throne he's on and how many screens he's got, but I bet it's many and it's a big throne.
Just before we go back to green, we were talking about helmets just before this the last commercial break, and Dr. Steve Olvey, who's one of the top medical
charge
experts
in charge capacitor 60% throttle before the restart
in terms of safety for motorsport safety in the United States, and he said if you buy a $50 helmet, it's good for a $50 head. Good point. So always buy the best helmet that you possibly can.
Absolutely. You just heard there, go at 50% throttle right now in order to charge the capacitor. That was the order, so that they've got some extra boost on board for the battle ahead. So Toyota thinking ahead of the game right now, and that supercapacitor which they carry, it's a bit like a battery, the old flash guns if you like, takes a while to actually wind up. 50% throttle, can he use it right now? Away we go. We are racing once again here at Le Mans, and immediately Tom Christensen just noses out from traffic and tries to close down this gap, and it's a decent one.
Yeah, he's a good get a jump there by Alex Wurz in car number seven. It's the saving off the inevitable, however. It won't be long before the number two car comes flying past. I think the Audis have been quicker all week significantly, but it's certainly in the cooler conditions overnight. There wasn't a lot to choose between the Audis and the Toyotas, but I fancy as much as anything else that might have been just the fact that Audis had a pretty firm grip on things and were able to just sort of dictate their own pace, if you like. But you know, there's no doubt both teams have done a fine job, and we've still got all five factory cars from Audi and Toyota still running and running strongly.
Absolutely. You only need one car to win it, of course. Oh. My goodness. On the restart, that's the Bellici Lola, and unfortunately it was the lead Lola running
fifth
in
place.
Fifth place.
Yeah, that's here's a replay here. Ooh, mama. He just got sideways there, Damien.
Yeah, that's just pitched him straight into the barrier there. Obviously, he's lost that nose, which is quite a big section, and quite a lot of money also.
Cold tires there.
Cold
he just
tires,
overcorrected,
yeah.
Didn't he?
Yeah, it was just
a car got sideways.
And the exit of one of the chicanes.
He put some opposite lock on the front end grips. It just threw him stage right into the wall. A heavy impact.
It's called
Andrea Bellicchi.
An overcorrection, if you like. Not to take away from the driver there at all, but you can see actually the nose tub of that car is quite badly damaged.
That's the Jota Sport car as well, which was right in the thick of the battle.
Wow, and the number 92 car, which was well placed.
It was running third place in the GT Pro class. Yeah, Mark Lieb as well. Great experience from him. But on his outlap as marked, and unfortunately, getting it a little bit wrong. Driver's trying to snatch at it, Jeremy.
Yeah, dramatic restart, certainly, in all sorts of instances. At the impact, well, the...
Oh, it was second double place, Bernard as well in the Porsche. Also getting involved, the 91 car.
It was the 61.
I beg your pardon.
61, yeah. The fourth place car in GTR.
Marco Cerchi.
Yeah.
Goodness me, it's taken plenty of prisoners, and this is the worst example of it. That's a real shame. He's going to be almost weeping, I imagine, because you know what? This was a potential with issues for other people. Podium for these guys.
Safety car
back out. My goodness. Well, they say cautions breed cautions, Jeremy Shaw, and we've had a rack full of them.
We have indeed. And
almost a bellyful.
Awful news for Rebellion Racing. Bart Hayden, he'll be distraught. The number 12 car has been in the pit lane for a little while with an undetermined, which we haven't yet determined what the problem is. But now the sister car, number 13 car, Andrea Balica. They've done a fabulous job, number 13 guys. Andrea Balica sharing that car with Matthias Besch and Kong Fu Cheng, Frankie Cheng from China. They were running that at a pretty much a flawless race, and now it's all gone horribly wrong.
Yeah, that's not at all what they want at this stage. Look at the damage to the barrier.
Oh, no.
Wow.
Well, that may be extended if they deem that is unsafe. And, well, I can't think why.
That's just the bottom rail.
They would deem it safe, but we'll see. Safety car has been deployed yet again. We've kind of lost count, but I think it's 10. There you go.
I think it's 9, unless there was one while I was away overnight. I was away for an hour, a couple of hours, but... If I miss one, it's 10, otherwise it's 9.
Yeah, I think it is 10, but okay. We'll have to double-check. Can't remember when you were not with us, Jeremy.
I left at about 3:30.
The hardest working man in Le Mans, by the way. He's on other duties when he's not with us, and it's a delight to have somebody so in touch with it. And there is more debris falling from the vehicle. Looks okay from the rear, doesn't it? But it's very second-hand.
Sorry-looking sight. I don't know what they're going to be able to do that because the front nose section there of the tub, which is carbon fibre, it looks like the nose, all the bodywork will fit onto that, but that looks to be badly bent and damaged. Even the rear is damaged.
It was the front nose, though, was it? Not the back nose.
Not the tail.
Yeah, it's a push-me-pull-you.
Front tail.
I remember Dr. Doolittle.
Yeah, dear.
Yes. Check out the nose.
Look at the damage to the front of the monocoque, too, there.
That's what I was...
How are they going to hang panels on that? Yes, exactly.
Yeah, I think that could be a lengthy repair, to be honest.
Particularly when the speeds, there's no way, is there? The speeds they do here at Le Mans, you cannot send a car out of the pit lane until it's assuredly safe.
And this is definitely big boy stuff. There'll be no mess in here.
What a shame.
Does that do it? It will keep at least Alex Wurz on the same lap as Stefan Sauerland, so he won't go that two laps down. So certainly good news for the car number 7 here. The bad news is I think he's still going to be caught up by that second pace car, so he's still half a lap behind, but that's at least gained him half a lap over where he was on this restart we had just a few minutes ago. In P2, Bertrand Baguette had managed to get himself a whole pace car ahead of the second place car in P2. That would be his teammate, David Heinemeier Hansen, number 24 car, and that will remain the case. And then the next two cars in class, Jan Martinborough in car number 42, Mike Conway in car number 26, they are both one lap down to the Oak Racing pair.
I just went to see the driver exit here, and I don't think Andrea Bellici is going to want to talk to anybody. Liz Halliday is going to be in the pits and talking, but I don't think you're going to get much word out of these boys. They're going to be busy.
In GTE Pro, Bruno Senna in car number 99 still leads, and it looks like he has a whole lap advantage right now over Timo Bernhardt in the number 91 Porsche, and Peter Dumbreck, who's at the wheel number 97 car.
and Mark Lieb in the number 92 Porsche. Those second, third and fourth place cars are separated by not very much, but they do seem to be a lap down to the leader, Bruno Senna, for Aston Martin Racing.
Damien, just how you cope with something like this? You've got to deliver the message.
Well, I actually think he's thinking on safety there, and certainly there seemed to be a doctor or an official there taking him out the back, but he got out very, very gingerly there. You know, he's probably hurt his back there, or he's probably sore, I would imagine, because that was quite a shunt. You see a lot of the carbon fibre damage on the front. That's the tub, that's the monocoque. That's very, very robust, very strong. And it takes a lot to penetrate that.
It does. And it's probably a 100-mile-an-hour hit that he took there against that barrier. So, you know, that's a shock to the system.
It is going to be a barrier repair. They have the chief engineer coming through and just taking a look at it. And I think that's just... I'm hoping that that's just a little bit of overburn here, or underburn. Green light to get back out and be collected by the safety car. Guys, there is a possibility that you can that you can overheat if you are held up for some time with engines running. We've even heard safety cars being told to speed up just so that cars can keep enough cool air running through the system.
Yeah, and or keep the tyres up to operating temperatures as well. Of course, they can turn off these engines. They have to turn them off during pit stops in any case, so they do have, unlike Formula One cars, they do have onboard starters. So when you get to the end of the pit lane, you'll generally shut off the engine until you're ready to go again. And then just fire it up and drive away, hopefully.
Refettling. Now, it's going to take quite a bit, we reckon, to actually tidy this up. Mind you, that looks like a cover's disappeared and we've got something a lot fresher being displayed to us right now.
Yeah,
it may well have been the housing that held the nose.
I think it was. I think it was. It's probably called the nose box.
Yes.
And that's been screwed off there. You can see all the brake calipers and the brake fluid tanks just there.
Jig being brought in just to check everything is square and ready. And this looks, I think you can be reasonably optimistic that this car might get back out. I don't think we'll be seeing Bellucci again. He looked in some pain, some distress.
Do you think the only cars we didn't talk about a few moments ago was the GTE AM?
Left exit, second chicane. There's debris on the right-hand side. It's going to be a long repair, I think.
That's the word to Tom Christensen in the leading car number two. Extensive repairs to that barrier on the exit of the second chicane on the Mulsanne Strait, as we saw. In GTAM, it's the IMSA performance car. Christophe Bourré sharing that car with Jean-Carl Vernet and Raymond Narak. They are leading, but Lorenzo Carse in car number 55, the Ferrari, is back on the lead lap now in second place. He shares that car with Giuseppe Perazzini, who was involved in that crash last year with Anthony Davidson, and Dallo Young, the Chinese-Canadian, or Canadian-Chinese, carries dual citizenship. They've done a nice job to keep that car in contention all the way through this race. They are... I think Lorenzo Carse is behind us, presumably the second of the pace car, so almost a lap down, but not. He is on the lead lap. In third place in GTE AM is Patrick Dempsey in the car number 77, the Dempsey Del Piero Racing Porsche, running in conjunction with Proton Competition, and they are a lap and a half. Maybe two laps now. No, yeah, where are we?
I think it's two laps.
Yeah, I think it is two laps now. Behind the leader in GTE and fourth place.
Safety car might last a bit because the barrier is damaged.
Again, the information there being passed along to Stefan Sarrazin in second place in the number 8 Toyota. And a fourth place in GTE AM, car number 61. That is the AF Corsa car, Jack Gerber, shown at the wheel of that car right now. He shares that number 61 car with Matt Griffith from Ireland and Marco Chiocchi, who stepped out of it a little while ago. Fifth place in GTEM, fifth place, yes, is Ricky Taylor, car number 50 for Labra Competition. He's another couple of laps behind. They've had a few little niggles, but Ricky Taylor, along with Patrick Bornhauser and Julian Canal, who have won this race for the last couple of years, certainly won it last year,
They've run it the last 2 years, and they are running now fifth place in the Chevy Corvette car number 50.
Interestingly, Patrick Dempsey is on board, and after the spin of the 61 Ferrari that we saw earlier on, he's on for a podium. He's struggled to get here, he said, not out of lack of enthusiasm, but just an opportunity in a very busy schedule, one would imagine. And to have a podium would be absolutely outstanding for the Dishy Doc, as he's known.
Yeah, I mean, you have to hand it to Patrick. He's put an awful lot of work into this, and I think he's come an awful long way from where he was even this time last year. So, you know, fair play to him. Obviously, he's been, you know, well coached as well. Andy Lally's doing a good job with him, I think, in the US. And then, obviously, Patrick Long is his teammate here, and he's obviously given him great information. But, you know, full credit to Patrick, he's doing a stellar job.
Well, you know what, he's going to have to watch his back, because the 61 Ferrari is on the same lap as Mr. Dempsey, and at the restart, that's going to be a scrap. So we'll find out exactly what kind of credentials he's managed to dial into himself. He has worked extraordinarily hard to move away from being first thought of as an actor to being primarily badged as a racing driver, and he's getting very close to that.
Yeah, he's improving all the time, and you know, thanks to instruction he's getting on the scene, both from Andy Lally, as you said, Damien Faulkner, in the United States, and with Patrick Long here. It's a super team, both in the States and here. Some of the crew guys are here from the States. It's primarily run by the Proton Competition guys, who are regulars in the European GT Series, but... Yeah, for Dempsey Del Piero Racing, that's Alessandro Del Piero, the Italian footballer who's a partner with Patrick Dempsey in this team. They're running primarily in the United States. They made their debut as that organisation at Sebring. Andy Lally put the car on the pole, and here he comes to Le Mans for the first time, and he led a goodly portion of it. Patrick himself at the wheel was for quite a long time, and now in the podium position currently. So whatever happens, the outcome of this race, hats off to Patrick Dempsey and Joe Foster and the rest of that organization.
Work still going on, and barriers as well. Thankfully, it looked like it was a low down repair, and we saw one bent piece of Armco going away, and it looks like we might have a fairly rapid response here. If a stanchion isn't taken out and it just happens to be the main body, if you like, of the Armco, it deforms and is removable without actually taking any of the supporting struts from that out. And as a result, we get a quicker repair. And it looks like we might be lucky enough to have hit between the uprights on the Armco, which would be great.
That would be good. We replaced a lot of Armco this week, but it's certainly a little bit worrying that anytime the Armco has had a...
She's worrying about keeping fuel, saving fuel.
There we are.
Stop it.
Forget about putting heat into the tyres. Just save the fuel.
Yeah, that was the word there to Jan Mardenborough, who is driving that number 42 car and doing a stellar job, running in third place. Just into the pit lane, then a couple of people, one guy into the pit, certainly. Here it is, the class leader in LMP2 is Bertrand Baguette, who brought that car into the pits. Routines at full service here for Oak Racing. This, I think, he'll rejoin behind the next safety car group, which might drop into second place in the class. So these two Oak Racing machines, I don't know where the number 24 car is in terms of its pit strategy. I think it was in, I would suggest, about 20 minutes or so ago, so maybe halfway through a fuel stint. But I think we're going to have quite a battle on our hands between these two. Whether this will allow either Roman Rusinov, who is driving the number 26 car, currently in fourth place, or Jan Mardenborough in the number 42 car in third in the class, whether this will allow them to move on to the lead lap with the two Oak Racing cars, I'm not sure. I don't think it will, but we shall wait and see.
We just saw an overhead shot of that barrier there that's damaged. In fact, it looks like the guardrail is damaged. All of it's damaged right to the top. I'm not sure if they're going to have to replace the two top rungs there, but we'll find out pretty soon.
We're just disappearing out of the bottom of our screen. We just saw the Vipers on course at the moment, two of them in fact, one at the bottom of or towards the rear of the GT Pro, And in fact, both of them there. Just having a look. Only two other from the GT Pro behind them, the 66 Ferrari of Alcabassi and Bill Oberland in the 98 Aston Martin as we speak.
It blew up, didn't it? It apparently.
Yes, exactly. They've had all kinds of issues, the Vipers. It is an early part of the SRT program, the street racing technology, although the mark, of course, the badge, the Viper, has been around for some time and has been within the houses of Dodge and Chrysler. Street racing technology, SRT, I'm not quite sure what I want to think about those initials and how they sort of trip off the tongue. But I know that Dodge was always known as a truck manufacturer before the Viper came along, and gave it a huge boost in terms of public recognition and kudos. And I think the street racing technology division is hoping for a similar kind of kick out of that vehicle.
Yeah, I was talking to Ryan Dial, who of course won the class in P2 last year with Starworks Motorsports. He's driving one of the Viper drivers now, and he does the long distance races for that team in the United States in the American Le Mans Series. And you know, he said, look, hey, we didn't come here expecting to be contending for the win. He did say, you know, we thought we'd be a little bit more competitive, but hey, for the first time here, this car is less than a year old, relatively speaking, very little development on this car. They just came here to pick up data, hopefully to get both cars to the finish line and just learn as much as they possibly can and come back stronger next year. You know, there isn't the opportunity to test anywhere in America in a track that's even vaguely applicable to what they will learn here at Le Mans.
Yeah, that's a bit embarrassing.
Just slightly so.
just right in front of the incident as well.
Yes, Stefan Raffa out there in car number 39. That car's been going backwards probably almost as much as been going forwards during this race. But to spin under the yellow, he's going to get a severe hand slap there from race control at best.
Yes.
That's not good.
No, it isn't. And right on camera as well. Yes, not sparing his blushes.
Can I just give a shout out to Jim McWhirter, whose JMW team are 11th in class, 41st overall, as they've just tweeted. And they said, the wonderful thing is, we're still running. So we want to see the checkered flag.
Yeah, good lads.
A very modest reply, I think. I just spoke with himself and his wife the other day, so lovely people.
They've had a tough week, haven't they? Because there was a big crash earlier in the week.
Of course.
To work very hard
to repair it.
They've had various niggles during the race as well, so that's right. You know, perseverance, that's what it's all about.
Works Ferrari drivers, and Andrea Bertolini is driving there with Khaled Alkabassi and Abdelaziz Al Faisal, two guys I know very well from the Middle East.
Caroline Stewart writing in and saying it's a bit unfair to say the Dodge were all about trucks before the Viper. You forget the classic days of the 60s and 70s, the Charger and the Challenger. Yes, and they've reignited those. I think the truck connection being the engine block that they actually took out and put into that car was something to behold. And in fact, I think they're even available up to sort of 8 litres. The rumble you get from that on a two-seater sports car, something quite outstanding. But yes, I take your point, Caroline, but yes, it was indeed their avowed intent as a publicity machine to get people thinking about cars again. You're quite right, in the 60s and 70s, because Dodge had become kind of a pickup truck brand, and the Viper helped them steer themselves back to the glory days. You're absolutely right, with the Charger and the Challenger. We welcome back Liz Halliday once more. Liz, we've had some embarrassing moments. This is one of them. There we are.
My goodness.
We thought it was tub damage. Thankfully, it seems not. It was the nose block that was there. We bid fond farewell to Jeremy Shaw. He'll be back in a little while. There it is. We thought that was the tub damage. It seemed not. Thank heaven for that as well. Bellici exiting the car and doing so very, very gingerly. Yes, no showboating there at all. He'd taken a bit of a hit, as more than that, as you can see. And so a full checkout of that vehicle. We've then had others taking a little bit of a spin underneath the yellow, underneath the safety car, I should say, behind it. The safety cars have been deployed, all three of them, because it's barrier repair time yet again, Liz.
Yeah, no, this has happened so much. Again, another theme of this Le Mans is just barrier repairs. It seems to go on forever. And this team has done such a good job. It's such a shame for them. And I know a lot of these guys, I've been lucky to work with a lot of them that are here, and they're such a great bunch of guys. And is this another Aston Martin stopped? Is it just spun?
No, that's the 98.
Has that already been there? Okay, yeah. I was going to say, I was getting worried. I was thinking, oh my goodness, is that another one? Unfortunately, I was struggling to see when I wasn't on air exactly who it was. They all look the same from a distance.
Hey, don't rip that off.
Oh,
somebody's ripping off the Michelin, one of the...
If you're going to affect a repair, then now's the time to do it. I don't know where that now came from.
Next to you, it's
been with Davian Faulkner too long.
Irish Northern Ireland accent.
You can just see they seem to be removing one of those. What do you call them? A sleeping policeman?
Effectively, yes. It's part of the ribs of
that
curbing. They'll be replacing it. They've taken lots of hits. We were talking earlier on about the fact that drivers have not been told to respect the limits of the track, which is a call you often get. And in fact, we were speculating as to whether it had spun out into the number of punctures that we've been getting. It's either that or the debris that has been strewn across the track. Carbon fibre has been everywhere, it seems, throughout this Le Mans. We believe 10 safety car periods. We've got conflicting reports as to whether it's 9 or 10. It depends on how you count
it.
You took your sleep.
Let's go for 9.5, shall we?
Nice, happy medium.
This is that car, Damien, that they've been busy with, and they're going to be busy for some time, by the looks of things.
Yeah, both cars in there. You can see that, God, they're grinding, the sparks are flying. So they're getting on well with that barrier repair. Looks like they've repaired all three. Sorry, Liz.
No, I interrupted you. I wasn't trying to. Sorry. I wonder how much Armco we've used.
And I thought you were missing me.
In feet.
I think
Euros.
I think that was a private conversation that just dipped in on there.
Nice to hear them having a little bit of a laugh at this stage of the race as
Absolutely,
well. I think
yes.
That's great.
With exactly... in 3 seconds, 6 hours remaining. Now, that's a massive ask. When you have done 18 hours and you've still got 6 hours to go, it tells you all you need to know about the significance of this race and just how difficult that is to mind, body and soul. 16 one-and-a-half-hour Formula One Grand Prix all rolled into one, and running not that dissimilar in terms of pace.
And we're now approaching a 1,000-kilometre race, basically, aren't we? 6-hour race left to go, which in itself is a long haul.
Amazing,
you would find if you went to just do a 6-hour race at Le Mans, you'd think, oh, that's a pretty long race. It's the end of this one.
This is how we stacked up. Tom Christensen is our leader in the two car, the two Toyotas, close at hand, but, well, we don't think close enough. But do not count your chickens, because Toyota, they have never counted them. And they are just hoping that this becomes their game. We have Audis in positions 4 and 5 as well. So Audis and Toyotas at the top of the timing screens. That's what we expected. Perhaps not in the order that we've got. While we're going to take our leave from some of you in around about a minute's time, we'll be staying with others. If you want to find us within the Eurosport family, then please pick up your remote control and just nip over to your alternative Eurosport channel, 1 and 2 international, that kind of thing. You will find us. We're not going anywhere.
Well, we're not.
Anyway,
for the next couple of hours.
No, I'm not going anywhere for 20 minutes, so. And then I'm going in the pits.
Are you going to bring us breakfast?
Well,
hey, listen,
I'm going to interview some people, and then I might bring you some breakfast.
Thank
you. It'd
be
really nice.
Just in case you think we're imposing ourselves, Liz did offer to cook the other night, and I stepped in, and I cooked.
It was very nice, by the way.
He did a fantastic job.
All of you think Carlton Kirby can't cook. There you go. He can. It's very nice.
Yes. I'll issue a recipe. This year's Le Mans pasta. We'll take our leave from some of you. Others, well, stick around.